हेलो आशीष
यस सर,
आशीष,
यस सर।
आई विल बी यूजिंग माय ओन स्लाइड हियर फ्रॉम माय कंप्यूटर। फाइन, लाइक
ओके
यस्टरडे।
ओके सर।
व्हेन टाइम कम्स ना, इट विल बी शेयर्ड।
यस
यस श्योर।
यू जस्ट ओपन योर स्लाइड्स प्रोजेक्शन, देन
यस
यू गो फॉर।
गुड मॉर्निंग। मॉर्निंग। सुधीर, आर यू एबल टू सेंड टू मी? Are you able to listen? Hello. हेलो मिस्टर सुधीर। हेलो,
He is joining just in 1 minute or 2 minutes. Due to some network issue, he is joining, sir.
हेलो,
गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग।
गुड मॉर्निंग सुधीर।
प्लीज अदर्स म्यूट प्लीज।
हेलो,
गुड मॉर्निंग।
हाँ, मैं जॉइन करता हूँ।
आशीष, हेलो आशीष, वी कैन स्टार्ट? नो,
हाँ सर, सुधीर इज जस्ट
योर सुधीर सुधीर हैज जॉइन्ड।
यस सर,
सो गुड मॉर्निंग टू एवरीबॉडी। ऑनरेबल वाइस चांसलर ऑफ सेंट्रल एग्रीकल्चर यूनिवर्सिटी इम्फॉल एंड today's chairman Dr. B.S. Whist, honorable former vice chancellor G.B. Pant University, and Dr. Dilip Kumar, honorable former vice chancellor of CIFE Mumbai, and other panelists and other participants delegate. Today is the second day, is the third session, challenges, opportunities. One thing that is opportunities in agriculture, engineering and post-harvest technology in COVID era. So there will be total, including the our keynote speaker, 8 speakers are there. So time allotment also is there. I will request our honorable chairman of this session, Dr. B.S. Whist, to start the session with the keynote address speaker, Dr. K.K. Shatpati sir, ex-director. Please, Shatpati sir, you are our wish sir. We can start with unmute your. Thank you to all.
Sir, your video is not coming due to some reason.
K.K. Shatpati sir, yes, okay.
So your video is not coming.
The video?
Hello, good morning to everybody. So our honorable chairman of today's session, third session, our Dr. B.S. Bis, honorable former vice chancellor, G.V. Panti University Technology, and all the speakers, panelists, seven panelists, and our keynote speaker, Dr. K.K. Satpathy. So the opportunities in agriculture, engineering, and post-harvest technology in COVID era. So I request our honorable chairman to conduct the proceedings. And the time allotment is also there for keynote speaker. It is 30 minutes. For other panelists, 15 to 20 minutes. So kindly proceed, sir. I welcome our Dr. B.S. Bis to this technical session.
Speaker Satpathy, you can start presentation, please.
Satpathy sir, आपका presentation open करके share में जाइए.
It is still disabled. Share में जाइए.
This is are you able to listen to all?
Yes.
Professor B.S. Good morning. Are you able to listen to us, please? Dr. Saha, Professor Dilip Kumarji, all the panelists, are you connected and are you able to listen? Good morning to everyone. We now hear K.K. Satpathy. The topic is scope and opportunities of agricultural mechanization in Northeast Hill Region. Dr. Satpathy, can you please start your presentation?
Satpathy, sir. Please start your presentation.
Okay, this
yeah.
Am I audible? Can you hear me?
Yes.
You can hear
projection
me.
Projection mode mein jaiye, sir. Yes. Projection mode mein jaiye.
Ah, gaya. I am audible. No, you can hear me. Can you hear me?
Yes. Sir, please put in the projection mode.
It is audible. Kindly put in the projection mode. Slides.
Yes, I have put it. Hello? Is it okay?
Are you okay?
Okay, good morning, everybody.
You have You have half an hour, including question hour session.
Honorable Bhai, there is some problem of hearing. Should I start now?
Yes, you start. Sir, projection mode mein jaiye. Projection mode slide.
Yes, right, man. Can't you see? I put it in projection mode.
No, it is not in projection mode.
Projection mode.
Full screen mode.
Full screen.
Full screen mode.
Full screen mode.
Full screen. Full screen.
नहीं वो आदमी है ना वो साथ में असिस्टेंट भी है ठीक है स्टार्ट प्लीज
इज इट ओके
यस इट इज ओके
ओके गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीबॉडी आई एम वेरी
गुड मॉर्निंग
चेयरमैन डॉक्टर बीस्ट और वाइस चांसलर रंजीत सिंह एंड पार्टिसिपेंट्स I see a lot of familiar faces, Dr. S. N. Jadav, Dr. Patre, Dr. Bora, and many others. I am very much thankful to you all for inviting me for this to speak in this important seminar. As I have a very emotional attachment to Northeast, having served about 29 years in different projects in all 7-8 states, I think today it's a new experience speaking without a live audience. Probably it will take a little time to become comfortable. I think you will bear with me. I think I'll be able to reach you all. I want to speak on spoke. And scope and opportunities of agricultural mechanization in NEH region. As you all know, this northeastern region is characterized by very difficult terrain, wide variation in slopes, altitudes, land tenure system, and cultivation practices. And this region is prone to quite a number of biophysical, infrastructural and socio-economic problem. This region, for historical reasons, remain behind the mainstream of country, especially in agriculture in allied sector. Normally, people follow very low input, low yield, low risk technology, permanent cultivation in valleys, plains, and some kind of shifting cultivation hills are the major farming systems here. Mostly people grow food crops.
Sir, slide change kijiye, slide change.
It's okay, I'll change it. No, I'll change whenever I need it. Is it okay? Are you able to hear me?
Yes.
Yes, I will change the slide when it's needed. Is it okay?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Is it changed? Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. I think people mostly grow food crops with hardly any commercialization in agriculture. We have to see mechanization in this context. This region could not catch up agricultural mechanization because of basically. Hello. This region could not catch up with mechanization because of terrain, because of farming practices, because of some kind of weak extension. Farm power is one of the most productivity constraints. Agricultural farm implement manufacturing is totally absent. And because of this appropriate mechanization, not much irrigation, irrigated areas, non-availability of modern inputs, and post-harvest technology, the productivity is very low. But in spite of these constraints, there is a great scope to mechanization and introducing mechanical power sources with matching equipment and post-harvest technology, agro-processing centers, which can grow long way to increase the productivity of this region. It will not only improve it will reduce the drudgery of the farmers. It will attract educated unemployment youths, unemployed youths to agriculture. Now, this hill zone, basing on this data of crops, crops, soils, livestock, crops, all these data, we, for the mechanism point of view, we can just divide into four zones. One is valley zones from 400 to 1000 meter. Mid hills 1000 to 1500, high hills 1500 to 3000, more than 3000. And in the first zone, it is mostly livestock, livelihood production system can be generalized as agri fish horticulture. It is the parts of Arunachal Pradesh, Meghalaya, Mizoram, Tripura, and Nagaland. And second, mid hill zone, it is agri horti livestock system. It's the past of Arunachal Pradesh, Meghalaya, Mizoram, Tripura, Nagaland, Sikkim, Darjeeling, and these kind of areas. Then we have high hills region. It can be said agriculture, horticulture, agriculture, livestock, fish. That is parts of Arunachal Pradesh, Meghalaya, Mizoram, Nagaland, and also temperate region, more than 3000. It is parts of Arunachal Pradesh and Sikkim. Now, as for the land holding is a concern, normally in hills, it is mostly collectively owned and it is governed by community by somewhat what is termed as a customary laws. And in this system, hardly any landless families are there, but operation land hills, it is like all India also, more than 78% land holdings are small and marginal, below 2 hectares. Now, according to agriculture tools and implements, it's mostly evolved during the Jhum system of agriculture. And it's thousands of years back, and same thing is continuing for quite a long time. And one of the most important farm implements is some kind of a multi-purpose, what is called a dao, which is used for many purposes, clearing jungles, cutting trees, and there is another for seed sowing that is called dibla. It's purely pointed bamboos. There are many other implements which is prevailing, that is spade, local plows, swinging basket, many other traditional field are there with very low field capacity. Now you can see that most of the traditional tools, and there is a variety of shapes and sizes of dows that is prevalent in many parts of the northeast. It is mostly made of spring steels. From the scraps of vehicle parts. Hello.
Other member can mute themselves. Sir, you can continue, sir.
Okay. And mostly by village blacksmiths with some kind of forging tools with the use of coal. And farm power availability is the most important production constraint in northeastern hill region. Farm powers are mostly in the form of human labors. Some places, of course, valley region, bullock power is also utilized. But in present situation, there was a variety of power sources, including that primitive shifting cultivation, there is a hoe culture, there is a plow culture, even some places there was a mechanical power system also used in a side by side. But overall, farm power availability is very, very low, which is shown in this slide. It's compared to all India figure.
Sir,
Horn power availability is a very important for productivity and food gain. If you just see a graph, it is highly correlated. It's a state-wise farm power availability and productivity, which our state has been got more farm power and its production yield is much better. So it is a critical input. Wherever, whenever there is a farm power availability is more in whichever state, agriculture grain yield is much more. And there are three type of, broadly we can categorize the farming systems. One is in shifting cultivation, one is terrace cultivation, one is hybrid cultivation, and mostly in human labor, manual labor is utilized, and some bullock power is there. And nowadays it is a, based on, it is a weekly energy distribution based on some 25 farmlands in different, it is in Meghalaya. And also this energy requirement is all operation, right, from threshing, transportation, harvesting. Whenever there is higher hills and you need more energy. Energy is, it is related very good and obtained. If it is more, it is more slopy, more high hills, it is energy requirement is more, much more. Now, there is, as we discussed, there is a lot of constraints in hill mechanization. There is a social problem, there is a physical problems, there was physical problems. Some of the problems are listed here. Some of the physical problems are soil erosion, landslides, poor water control, excessive soil moisture content throughout the cropping season, difficulty in operating farm machinery on steep slopes, movement of supplies and farm products due to poor transport and communication system, low soil fertility, small holding size, absence of land ownership, and similar thing. There are many social problems also, low literacy rates, but it is now correct. Literacy has gone much higher now. Inadequate contact with other communities to see what is going on outside their immediate premises. Reluctance to change traditional methods. Inherent distrust of outsiders. Inadequate research infrastructure and dearth of qualified researchers. Extreme dearth of trained extension personnel reaching communities living in far-flung villages. Lack of an integrated government programs for the effective use of hill lands. Some of the economic problems are also there. That is inability to raise adequate capital for improved hill farming, subsistence farming and low income, reluctance of rich landowners to invest and improve hill land farming because of its low inherent productivity and marginal profitability. So there is a great scope, even in spite of all these constraints, there is a great scope of farm mechanization in Northeast. There is a need for accelerated farming to increase the productivity. Farm mechanization is an essential driver for sustaining agriculture growth. Positive correlation between farm power availability and agriculture productivity, which I've shown earlier. Addressing scarcity of agricultural labor. It's a very serious problem nowadays in Northeast. Climate change mitigation and level of mechanization is significantly low. It is much low because of many historic reasons in Northeast region now. Now, Central Institute of Agriculture Engineering, Bhopal, they have studied some of the productivity influenced by mechanical mechanization. So some of the study says 5 to 10% improvement in yields by proper and timely seedbed preparation. 10 to 20% improvement in yield by using seed cum fertilizer drill. 5 to 30% improvement in yield through control of weeds by using intercultural tools, sprayers, and dusters. 4 to 5% saving through timely and efficiently harvesting and threshing operations. During post-harvest operation, the current A2 turpin launch and stored food gas can be saved by improved storage practices. A modern rice mill yields 2.5% more from raw paddy over shelterless and 5% over haulers and mules. Dal recovery can be improved by 10 to 20% by adoption of efficient processes and improved equipment. So our focused areas should be in this region, small and marginal farmers, reaching the unreached, rurally mechanized villages, custom hiring services, entrepreneurship, and creating ownership and capacity and awareness building. Now, in these hills, naturally, we need implements which will be small in size and lighter in weight, and it can be carried to field, and without much alteration, it can be utilized. Nowadays, some of the solution to this kind of situation is we need compact, light, low power, multi-purpose machines. We need locally available materials must be incorporated in fabricating these machines to reduce manufacturing costs. Small size tractors, mini power tillers, and small farming equipments must meet the needs of small farmers. Operator safety and comfort is an important area of concern. Energy efficient machines should be developed. Now there are a lot of lightweight small power tillers are available with matching equipment. And even there was a manually operated equipment like wheel hoe, seed drills, and threshing machines, and many of these equipments which can be used in hills are now available. Now there are quite a number of traditional tools and which can be replaced by immediately by recommended improve for slope cultivation. So there are engine operated cultivator, bush cutter, postal diggers, bush cutter with cultivator attachment, wooden stick with steel tip for dibbler, and many other things, serrated sickle, manual telescope, food harvester, small 1 to 2 HP thresher, animal operated diggers, carts, power tiller operated trailers. So there are many similar improved tools are available which can be used by small and marginal farmers even in hills, very interior places. So I think there are quite a number of implements, I think, authorized both from ICR and CAU also. They are moldboard plows, light rigger plows, APU animal down, quadlock, adjusted row makers. So many of these implements are somewhat, many are developed from traditional equipments. Like this row marker and all that. Some are brought from outside and modified, and some are developed here itself in Northeast by these two institutes. PU multi-crop seed drill, manually operated light transplanter, roll and paddy seeder, self-propelled rice planter, Huizo Hando, it was developed in Northeastern complex and it was very popular in many places. And sickle, knobbing sickle, self-propelled vertical conveyor reaper, pedal paddy thresher, which is also very popular, it has become popular now. This is also another tubular meshal, I think. From ICR complex, thousands and thousands it has been sold from complex. Groundnut decorticator. This is also another citrus harvester developed in ICR complex. Animal drawn potato digger. So this is the many, some of the implements. There are many other implements which is available, which can be extended to hill region of Northeast. Some of the opportunities to popularize is some of the things. Promotion and strengthening of agriculture mechanization through training, testing, and demonstration. post-harvest technology and management, financial assistance or procurement of subsidy for selected agriculture machinery and equipment, establishment of farm machinery hubs for custom hiring, enhancing farm productivity at village level by introducing appropriate farm mechanization in selected villages, creating ownership of appropriate farm mechanization among small and marginal farmers. Now, many of these equipment.
Sir, you have fiber to control this fiber.
Hello? Hello?
In fiber, can you please conclude?
Should I continue? Many of these equipment which I have discussed, many will be uneconomical for being owned by the individual farmers, and it should be collectively owned. So custom hiring is now a very important instrument through which Government of India is promoting for collective ownership of implements. So custom hiring is an important mechanism through which most smallholders can access services of agriculture machinery, is one option that can ensure the use of improved farm machinery even to small and marginal farmers, offers prospect of facilitating rapid mechanization of agriculture system in the region. So the objectives of this custom hiring is normally to make available various farm machinery equipment to small and marginal farmers to offset the adverse economic scale due to high cost of individual ownership, the mechanization in place to provide services for various agriculture implements for different operations, to extend mechanized activities during cropping season in large areas, especially in small and marginal farmers, to provide hiring services for various high value crops, specific machines and apply for different operations. So custom hiring is basically a unit comprising a set of farm machinery, implements and equipment meant to for custom hiring by farmers. Though certain implements and equipments are crop specific, and the trucks and utilities like tractors, power tillers, etc., as self-propelled machinery like combine, harvester, etc., are used in common. Therefore, an ideal model envisages to comprise farm machinery that are commonly used for tillage operations for all crops, multi-crop equipment, and minimum crop-specific machinery. So mostly this kind of group, same type of farmers, same close groups can form, otherwise cooperative producer organization, even agriculture unemployed graduates, some small businessmen, public-private partnerships, also this kind of services can be organized in villages. And success factors of this, you have a good business plan, skilled labor and support, and service of sustained enterprises. And this kind of business plan and models are available in Government of India. They are financing, they are giving a lot of subsidy for creating this custom hiring services in villages. So you should have an enabling environment for that. And these are the you should enabling environment consists of this kind of things. You have a repairing maintenance services, finance, credit, technical business, extension, inputs, field driver, staff, equipment, supply, outlets.
Yeah.
So that relevant areas that support custom hiring, that is facilitating the
we'll
development
like
of
to have support discussion.
Now, just one slide is complete. Facilitate the development of producer organization cooperatives that allow small holders to benefit from capacity building and access to institution credit and procurement inputs. Development on inclusive financial models to support small holders and landlords to take part in providing customized services. So there are the final my slide. These are strategies, development, what are the major strategies needed? Development and adoption of manually guided power tiller operated equipment for heavy training, farm machinery management for efficient and utilization available agriculture machinery, streamlining and testing procedure, training, engineering, and conducting testing farm equipment for standardization and quality control of farm equipment manufacturing, development of package tool farm equipment for major cropping system for different states, multiplication of R&D products at prototype manufacturing workshop for multi-location trials, establishment of farm machinery hub for machines being manufactured elsewhere in the country and supply to users, conducting prototype feasibility testing and frontline demonstration of improved farm implements and machinery, different regions to bridge mechanization gaps and obtain feedback for design requirements, promoting custom hiring services through entrepreneurship for use of high capacity farm equipment for ensuring timeliness operation, reduction in cost of production, increased interaction among farmers, R&D workers, development of agriculture and industry to have access to latest equipment and technology. Thank you. I think I conclude with
thank
this.
Thank you, Dr. Satpathy, for very interesting and very useful presentation, which present-day access and well as our future as well. In your presentation, you highlighted because of different terrain, because of low productivity, low strategies are being used. The need is to improve productivity and also employment opportunities in rural areas. You put it that new farmers and entrepreneurs cannot buy all the CV. They can have custom hiring services utilized, they will utilize. Plus, you also that there has to be concentrate hubs, manufacturing hubs around in the northeast, specifically. Which is moving on other parts of the country or elsewhere, which is tested there, is tested there, and then distributed. So thank you so much. Now we invite you questions. Please put up questions to Mr. Thank you so much. All of your lifetime experiences have been used today for the development of HL strategy. Thank you so much. Questions, please. If the audience like to have questions, I'd like to invite Dr. Yao. Are you around? Dr. Yao, please.
His
topic is obviously to support agricultural access in Northeast. Dr. Ashton Yadav, please. Sudhir, can you put up to Dr. Yadav?
Yes, sir, he is doing.
Yes, mechanism to support sustainable crop production. Dr. Yadav, please start.
I'm audible, sir.
Yes, sir.
You are audible, not visible, of course, but your slides are visible. Please go ahead.
Good morning, respected Vice Chancellor CAV Impal, Professor M.P. Jit Singh, sir. Professor B.S. Bish, former Vice Chancellor, G.V. Pant University, Pantnagar. Dr. Satpathy, former director, Dr. Ratan Sahaji, D, other panelists, and delegates. Good morning to all of you. After the detailed deliberation presented by Dr. Satpathy about the mechanization, I don't know what is left for me to speak, but anyway, I will try to add something which may be added in the, I mean, recommendations of this program. So the topic is the scope of farm mechanization to support sustainable crop production in post-COVID scenario. So I will try to elaborate the post-COVID scenario in the country and then how we can mitigate some of the constraints through harm mechanisms. So we can see the population dynamics before our COVID-19, which was around, we can see that it was about 20%. And recently we have seen that around 6 to 7 crore, that is 60 to 70 millions of workers, they have re-migrated. Re-migrated means who were migrated from the village to the cities. Now, because of the pandemic, they have re-migrated to villages. So we have to see that how we can engage them in the agriculture through mechanization. So power availability scenario, if we see, sir, during 1950-51, the total animal power availability was 24.7 million. Million kilowatts, which reduced to 18.8, and at the same time the tractor power availability was increased 0.21 to 211 million kilowatts, and this shows that our contribution of animate source power is reducing day by day, whereas our Indian agriculture is supported by the animate powers. If we talk particularly about the integrated farming or the organic farming, the number of tractors, if we can see, 1960, 61, 62, it was nearly 880 numbers. Now it is more than 50 lakhs. So this indicates that we are using the number of tractors in the agriculture. And when we are using, sir, the tractors, we have seen that tractor is also used for haulage purpose through trolleys, and it is supposed that around 4 workers can be engaged for haulage of either the agricultural produce or even the construction and materials. When it is off season, the tractors are engaged there. So about four persons are engaged with one trolley. If there are 50 lakh tractors, so around 20 million workers can be engaged with the tractor trolley.
Though you have 10 minutes, please come to the point.
Okay, sir. So for power availability, just now Dr. Satpathy has already given the data. I'm talking here about availability 2013-14 and based upon 1670. This is the data given by the Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare. So average availability of farm power availability in NES region is around 0.63 kilowatt per hectare. And it is increasing by 38%, approximately 38%. So if we consider the 38% increase in power availability, so from 16 to 70, presently it is around 0.8 kilowatt per hectare available farm power in any region, as compared to 2.54 kilowatt at national level. Just Satpathy sir has already explained this table, that there is a correlation between the increase in farm power availability and the productivity. So by 2030, with the same increasing population, we will require around 355 million tons of grains, for which we have to increase the farm power availability from currently 2.54 to around 2.8 kilowatt per hectare. Sir, this is something I just put for the our student delegates about the mechanization. I think it is not much relevant. We considered the only the tractor used, then we call it mechanization. Actually, this is the machinery used for crop production as well as for the irrigation, post-harvest processing, dairy applications. All these combined machineries which we use, we all include into the mechanization. And it may be partial or the complete mechanization. And we in India, we generally recommend the partial mechanization because we cannot replace all the animal and human power from the agriculture. If we replace them all, then we call it complete mechanization. So it is we generally say that we may go for the partial mechanization, not the complete mechanization. That is sustainable mechanization, shifting from subsistence farming to commercial farming. Sustainable mechanization supports the development of food supply through improved agricultural practices. Sustainability suggests interdisciplinary efforts. Actually, here I want to all the research, education, farmers, farm workers, consumer, all they have to work together. Interdisciplinary action is required for sustainable mechanization and sustainable crop production. This is the one of the thing I wanted to put the FAO. The FAO, they said that mechanization should not be introduced in a hurry or on a too large scale. To make mechanization successful, it should be gradually expanded as it is not feasible under the present agricultural structure of India. So we have to go slow, step by step. Role of mechanization, I will not discuss this. Dr. Sapathy has already explained about the benefits of the mechanization. This is all he has covered. Then the challenges ahead, also he has given a lot of emphasis on what are the challenges. That is small and fragmented land holdings, delivery mechanism of the farm machinery, that is very not in a proper way. Accessibility to the farm machinery is very poor for the farmers because of the their economic conditions and availability of appropriate technology, industrial institutional framework, where all the institutions, maybe the state government particularly, there should be coordination between the institutions to mitigate the challenges.
Dr. Yadav, you may like to conclude now.
Yes, sir. It will take hardly 5 minutes, sir. The way forward is only to identify the appropriate technology and sources from where it will be available, then adapt them by evaluating at the local level and evaluate the performance, validate the technology and propagate for this adoption, that is validation. So these are the three steps which is way forward for us. These are the some of the testing and farmer series should be taken up so that the farmers can get the good quality, and then establishment of farm machinery bank should be available so that farmers can hire it. Resource conservation technology should be given the priority. Technology release committee should be formed so that whichever technology is developed, it is can be shared with the state government for its popularization. Transfer of technology infrastructure needs to be strengthened. Development of organic farming and horticulture equipment is required. Some of the technologies which has been developed at our college, which are suitable for the NS region. This thing, sir, actually I wanted to put here. There was a big committee that is called National Round Table Conference Committee, which was held in January 2017. They have given some recommendation for increasing the mechanization, sir. Promotion of customary, as Dr. Sapathy already said, make in India support for farm implements, that is very important to mitigate the unemployment scenario after COVID. Farmers should be extended with financial assistance in the form of subsidy for the selected and quality machinery. They actually in subsidy, the government they decide that these are the machines to be put put into the subsidy, I think the farmer should be given the chance to select the machine, and their subsidy should be given on that machine, whichever the farmer want. Not that it should be decided by us. After sale service, that is very important part, because most of the time farmers are not able to find out the after sale services. So the key recommendations, there may be two major challenges ahead. That is, one is the agricultural production, and there was the rural unemployment. So short term goal should be that to increase the appropriate partial mechanization or higher productivity, which will provide the rural employment. Production of farm machinery under Atmanirbhar Bharat should be taken up. Establishment of tiny manufacturing workshop in the vicinity, so it will increase the rural employment. Establishment of custom hiring centers, it will increase the rural employment, as well as this will include the increase the mechanization, thus the crop production. And long term goal should be the concentrated research on resource conservation technology, strengthening of TOT infrastructure, strengthening of research capability of research and educational institutes. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Yadav. Maybe that we will keep the questions here for the end, because we are already running a little late. Now I'll invite Dr. P. Bora. He is speaking on small action for big difference, sustainability in agriculture, conservation, technology, Himalayan. Dr. Bora. Please, you can start. 20 minutes. If you want question answers, like now you face it in 15 minutes. 5 minutes for question answer. Otherwise, the questions also for the end.
Am I audible, sir?
Yes, sir.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
You are audible.
Respected Honorable Vice Chancellor, Central Eccles University, Professor B, sir. So, what I just wanted to present that, is it okay? Am I visible? Hello?
Is it okay?
Okay. Audible. Okay, please go ahead.
Yes, sir. Thank you. So, what I wanted to stress upon that is small actions that we can be taken during this emergency period. Well, a lot of people are coming back to their own places, and we are finding a critical situation. But since yesterday, we have been listening to a lot of shortcomings and the hurdles that Northeastern Agriculture Service, but I would emphasize that to Northeastern region that traditional water to Northeastern people, and most important, the sacred forest and ecosystem services. This is a unique thing to Northeastern hill region, that every community worships the nature. They have the sacred forest system, which is giving the major contribution to natural resource management, natural resource conservation. And then also Northeastern farmers, they put a loyalty to the traditional crops and varieties, and all in the farming system, sustainable farming system, we have got mixed cropping, mixed enterprises. And most importantly, Northeastern region has got unique biodiversity and cultural diversity. These are the strengths that we have. And during the emergency, instead of looking back to the shortcomings, we must address the strength that we have. So this traditional knowledge was the ecosystem sustainability was also, and it's also a nature worship type of thing. Then when we talk about a sustainable concept of farming system or financial sustainable concept, that is a budget neutrality. what is budget neutrality? It's obviously not zero budget. It's a budget neutrality means the balanced budget that we talk about. Then obviously our entire agricultural system must be water balanced, nutrient balanced, as well as climate balanced. If we can achieve this balanced budget, we can always have a sustainable farming system through natural resource management. And well, there is a problem that resource management activities hardly get the stakeholder support because this is always a government works. It's a top-down approach, and since government is preparing the program and government is implementing the program, and people feel that this is, since it's a government program, so why should we get involved? So that is a major drawback that we have in NRM activities. And then most often the farmers do not get direct and tangible benefit from the natural resource management activities because that gives benefit after a long time, which they really do not realize or do not understand this. And moreover, degradation is often very slow. Hence, farmers do not understand that their farm, their soil health is degrading or their farm is getting degraded. So this major problem that we find with the natural resource management activities among the farmers. Even when we try to train them, we really find a very mute response, or they do not understand that what we are talking about because they do not understand the entire degradation process. Often we find that the projects are made by the Government of India are a complex in nature for the farming community, and they always find it very alien to them. So these are the problems that we often find in, but see, the natural resource management also in India has become a very sectoral approach. And also when we go for sectoral approach in the natural resource management, obviously it's killed the entire, the philosophy of natural sustainability, natural resource management or resource sustainability. And obviously we understand that soil, water, flora, fauna must be considered in totality. And then, it really needs now paradigm shift, and I really fail to understand why social forestry is under forest department and why soil conservation and agriculture departments are working separately. Can we call them an NRM department? And it is very, very much important for a country like India that all the three or four departments would work together and call it NRM department instead of talking about forestry. In social forestry department, soil conservation is a separate department, and of course, soil conservation sometimes works with social forestry or forestry department, but we feel that all the departments have come together and have the common program. And the challenges in the COVID, the people are coming back and they do not have the employment. But the major advantage that we can explore that they are educated. Most of the people that they, from the Northeastern area, they have gone for different walks, they're educated. And they're exposed to the market economy. And they understand the concept of sustainability also. If we tell them, they'll really understand it. And then they know the market demand. What is the possibility for them to produce here and export to the metros of India? And that they know it very well. And moreover, I feel that NRM activities, though piecemeal basis is related to MNREGA, but I find that Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Program must be linked to the all NRM activities under Agriculture Department too. It should not be only in the DR under District Rural Development or the Block Development Office. It should come under the Agriculture Department also. And what is necessary? In the small action that I'm telling that before dam, let us talk about the small bund. Before reservoir, let us talk about the ponds. And before ponds, let us talk about the transit and micro terraces. And before terraces, let us talk about the barrier. And let us not get fascinated with the flowing water that is going to the downstream. Let us rejoice that when it disappears in the soil system or in the watershed itself. See, we must understand that there is a concept nowadays is very much prevalent with the water management people, which is called and we must understand that vegetation, soil, crater, rocks, they keeps lot of water both in blue and green form, and that should be utilized very well. And every land use decision is actually a water decision, and we must understand that. And when land use is decided, partitioning of the land use actually decide the partitioning of the rainfall and into runoff and infiltration, and then runoff contributes to blue water and infiltration contributes to green water. And green water, which is constituting around 60% of the total rainwater, which is stored in the soil system should be utilized and capitalized by the agricultural system. And this is what the entire global scenario, then we find that green water and a part of that also goes to groundwater, at this two part are only useful for the our production system. This, of course, the river water is sometimes goes back to the production system of irrigation, but this doesn't satisfy, as is, you see that 65% of the total rainwater can be green water, which can easily be utilized for agricultural production system. And this is how the
Gura, you have is done.
And then see,
please, you can,
sir,
you have 2 minutes now.
Sir, I leave around 5 minutes, sir. I'll just say wind up as early as possible. So any farmers that need to do to increase infiltration in the soil system and cut off the slope length, and this is a partitioning of rainfall occurs. This is what I have formulated a model, constitution model, that we can estimate the green water that we can conserve in our soil system, and any workers in the farm level, scientists or any field workers, not the farmers I'm talking about, who understand the model concept, and they can use this model and then estimate the green water that can be stored. And these are the GIS tools which can also be utilized for resource assessment. And these are the small models one need only to determine how much water can be stored in the soil system, and then that the people should work around that. And this is the things I always say, that instead of bond, one should go for trench, because this conserve both soil and water. And these are small eyebrow terrace. These are also very important in the hill ecosystem, and they conserve both soil and water. And there's always bench terraces are there. And this is what the very most important people should give much more concentration on this. And then these are some of the activities. And then what is that cutting the slope? It means the Francis is cutting the slope length. And this is not only storing soil, it's also store water here and give enough filtration for water. And this is, of course, for northeastern region, we need inward type bench terraces. Then what I have proposed, that for bench terraces, one should talk, because we always give drain out point to the natural drain. Instead of giving directly disposing water, we should conserve the water at every terrace level, so that the conserved water can be irrigated to the downstream terrace, as well as the excess water can be also transferred to the downstream another reservoir. So that a series of reservoirs can be constructed, a small structure, unless we call them zalkun. So small structure can be constructed, and it's on every terrace, and then that water can be utilized. The major reason why I'm telling that, because when water goes out of the water system, it is actually goes out of the total domain. So it is not used by the farmers. And when water goes to the downstream at the water harvest structure, it cannot be reused easily by the upstream farmers. That's why upstream farmers often not interested in the water conservation activities, because they do not give them direct benefit or direct revenue. It goes to the downstream farmer, who is to be pumped again, it needs extra energy. So instead of allowing water to go downstream, no doubt water harvesting structures are downstream also very good activity, which can be used by the farmer. Yes, I'll take only 2 minutes. So this is, yes, I'm concluding. This is made, sir, in a balanced way also, the precision farming and such nutrient. I am giving emphasis that now we have got soil health card. Of course, the not has become universal, but we should make it universal. And the soil health card should be linked to the cadastral map, as well as it should be registered to the farmer's name, and that should be geocoded. Once we geocode them, that should be brought into DSS system. And decision support system and decision support system can also be brought to the mobile app, so that farmer can use them. And we have got very good experience in M4Agri, and under that we could link our farmers for all agriculture management. That same thing can be done for national management activities also. And obviously we know that IoT is coming, drone is there. These are the next generation tools that can also be linked to the mobile sustain mobile platform, and we can design the mobile app for all another. So thank you very much. These are the things that I wanted to share with all the audience. Thank you, Dave, for giving me the opportunity. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Professor Bha. You have raised many issues which need to be considered, particularly farming communication technology, eco-sensitivity, eco-sustainability, and then also migrating workforce as far as the development of agricultural medicine is concerned. Thank you very much, and please be ready with some questions at the end. Thank you. Now we have Professor Mahesh Singh Sevna. He'll be speaking on role of renewable energy technologies for sustainable agriculture in any region in India. Professor Roda, please maintain your timings, which are 20 minutes time.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
You can give 5 minutes and 15 minutes. You can have some questions for you. Go ahead.
Thank you, sir. I audible, sir.
Audible, sir. Yes. I'd like to tell that in basic information, reserve your comments. Rather, you can go to the applied aspect of it and your experiences and your ideas. Well.
Thank you, sir. Respected Professor M. Premjit Saab, Honorable Vice Chancellor CAU, Dr. B. S. Bish Saab, former Vice Chancellor, Dr. K. K. Satpathy Ji, Dr. Dilip Kumar Ji, Professor R. K. Shah Saab, Ashish Khandelwal Ji, President Aisha, and all other participants, professors, good morning, all of you. My topic is role of renewable energy technologies for sustainable agriculture in NEH region. Today, the major portion of the energy demand is met by using conventional energy sources in all the sectors. But these conventional sources have some problems, caused adverse impact on our environment by way of greenhouse gases. The most abundant greenhouse gas emission is CO2, CH4, and 2O fluorinated gases. The effect of the greenhouse gases, the climate change, global warming, adverse impact.
Dr. Sevda, go in projection mode.
Your projection is not moving ahead.
Yeah, sir. It's okay, sir. It's okay, sir.
Okay, sir.
So that is the renewable energy sources are readily available in all over the world, including rural and remote areas. So that is the nowadays the renewable energy technologies are very important in the agriculture sector also, and particularly in the NEH region. This region is the very poor as the agriculture. Generally, all the people are directly related to agriculture and allied activities in the main source of the livelihood in our NEH region. The sustainable agriculture, it is a good balance between the economic and social and environment. Economical viable is very important. So that is the goal of sustainable agriculture, the providing more profitable farm income. It is very important. And second one is the social supportive. The quality of life of farmers also very important. So there are two forms of energy for energy-based social impacts. There are the first is that lighting and the cleaning cooking. So that there two are very important parameters in our life. So that the farmers also deserve to get lighting and the clean energy. So that is the social impact improvement is also very important. The ecologically point of view, we have to promote the renewable energy technologies and other green energy technologies. And renewable energy technologies, we have divided into six groups: solar energy, biomass, wind, hydro, ocean, and geothermal. Solar energy technologies is basically the energy obtained from the sun is the known as the solar energy. So that we are converting solar energy into another form of the energy, means the, for example, electrical energy, thermal energy, mechanical energy. So that there are the two roots of the energy, solar energy conversion technologies. First one is the solar photovoltaic technology. technology. Second one is the solar thermal technology. The global solar radiation in India, so that India basically is the blessed with the plenty of sunlight for the most of the year. So that here is the average solar radiation availability, 4 to 7 kilowatt hour, means the unit per meter square per day is availability, and average 250 to 300 sunny days. In the northeast region also very good solar radiation availability, around 4.5 to 5.4. So that is a very good solar energy availability are there. Solar photovoltaic technology, basically in the solar photovoltaic technology, we are converting solar energy into electrical energy by the using the solar photovoltaic cells. So that in the basic building blocks of the solar photovoltaic systems, including solar cells, after that the connecting the series and parallel, they make the solar modules, and the number of modules connected in parallel and series in electrically as per our requirement, so that we are getting the solar photovoltaic arrays. So that is we have to divide in the two groups of the solar photovoltaic systems. First one is the off-grid solar photovoltaic system. Second one is the grid-connected solar photovoltaic system. Generally, the area required for the solar photovoltaic system. So that generally, in the thumb rule of the 1 kilowatt solar photovoltaic system, generally required 10 meter square of the area. Actual sizing are depending on the local factors of solar radiation, weather conditions, efficiency of solar module. But generally, the 10 meter square area is sufficient. And 1 kilowatt solar photovoltaic system generate about 100 units per month, means 100 kilowatt hour per month is everywhere in our country. Off-grid solar photovoltaic system. This system is very important for the installed in the remote places where they didn't get the electricity by the grid electricity, and so that is generally the farmers. It is very important for the getting the light and electrical energy in the remote places. So that this system is consist is the generally the solar photovoltaic arrays directly connect the charge controller and some battery backup also, and this is the inverter they convert in the DC to AC load, so that is the we can use in remote places for the lighting purpose and other domestic purpose also. Second one is the grid connected system. This system is the directly connect to the grid, and it is the charge controller and inverter and directly connect to the grid, and one connection is in our house. So that is the this is the bi-directional meter system are there, so that is the two-way system. Electricity goes in the grid and come with the grid, the balance may be get as in the money to farmers and the household. Some benchmark cost of the grid connected rooftop solar photovoltaic power plants, it is decided by Ministry of New and Renewable Energy Sources, so that up to the 10 kilowatt 54 rupees per watt, and about in 200 kilowatt 48 and 100 to 535. These some rates are high in the northeastern regions due to the transport cost and other costs, so that generally the 60 rupees per watt cost in up to the 10 kilowatt in this region. So that some subsidy by the central finance assistance system by the government of India, up to 3 kilowatt 40% subsidy are there, and up to 10 kilowatt first 3 kilowatt 40% subsidy, and after that balance in the 20% of the subsidy is available, and about 10 kilowatt no subsidy available, up to the 40% 3 kilowatt and 20% next 7 kilowatt only. It is a very important application in the farming sector in the solar photovoltaic water pumping technology. Basically, this technology is as compared to the traditional solar traditional electric water pumping system is the same. Here is the use the solar energy instead of the grid electricity. So that is that there are the main component of the solar photovoltaic water pumping system. Solar photovoltaic array, we can connect the solar photovoltaic module parallel and series and parallel as per our requirement of the voltage and the current and the motor pump sets. It is the conventional motor pump sets are available, surface water pump and submersible pump. As per our requirement, we can use, and the electronic system is the maximum power point tracker. It is the solar, it is the controller system are there, interconnecting cables and all of this. This is a very easy system. So that is the irrigation pumps in India. What is the situation? The presently electric grid connected systems are 21 million and the diesel powered around 9 million. Totally the around 30 million pumps are there. Solar powered only 0.18 are there. This type of the solar surface DC pump pump sets are there. This is the schematic layout of the solar water pumping system we have developed and designed in the northeastern region. This is the one solar photovoltaic water pumping system installed around the DC motor. Is only a small motor we have to use, 0.14 HP. And the some schemes from the government of India, PM Kusum, Pradhan Mantri Kisan Urja Sanrakshan Evam Uthan Mahabhiyan. There are the three components and the scheme installed, started from the March 2019. And this is the component A for the means the install the power plants in the agriculture land, means ki barren land. And second component is this under scheme, farmers will support it to install around 17.5 lakh standalone solar agriculture pump up to the 7.5 HP. As component C is the solarization of the 10 lakh grid connected, means the grid connected solar photovoltaic grid connected water pumping system converting to solar water pumping system. So that some financial assistance are available from the central government and the state government. So that in the plain area, the central government assistant 30%, state government 30%, remaining 40% by the farmer. For the special provision for the northeastern states, the central financing 50%, state 30%, so that farmer may bear only the 20%. So that it is a very good scheme for the solar water pumping in the northeastern states. Second technology, the solar thermal technology. In the solar thermal technology, we are converting solar energy into the thermal energy or the heat energy. So that there are the number of applications are there: solar water heating, drying, cooking, distillation, space heating, cooling, and the solar thermal power technologies. So that one of the solar water heating technology, it is the most viable technology of all the low temperature solar water applications. So that the solar water heating system is devised to help the heating the water in the remote areas. Also, there are the no geyser systems, or there is the hot water is required. Generally, the hilly areas, the hot water is required in 24 hours in our kitchen, bathrooms, and in the other purposes also. So that there are the components of the solar water heating system is a very viable technology, and the solar collector, storage tanks, pipe, insulation. This is the number one type of the flat plate collector solar water heating system. This is the this is the view of installed of flat plate solar water heating system in the NEH region. And second one is the evacuated tube type solar water heating system. It is also viable technology in the northeastern region. So that we have installed in this technology in the northeastern region. And second one is that it is very important technology for the agriculture purpose. It is solar drying. Drying is very important parameter our post harvest technology. So that is the we have developed number of dryers. The first one is the direct type natural convection dryer. This is also very useful for the farmers. The temperature achieved around 55 to 60 degrees centigrade temperature. It is a sufficient temperature for drying of agriculture and horticulture products. This is the second one is the post convection type drive. We have used a solar panel, the 5-volt solar panel are there. Third one is the mixed mode type. This type of dryer that we are using is a direct and indirect type solar dryer techniques. This is the mixed view. One solar dryer we have developed with the solar biomass hybrid type system, so that we are using is the gasifier also and the solar also. so that it is also working. It is very good. And the one dryer we have developed is a solar tunnel dryer for the northeastern region. This type of dryer is we can walk-in type dryer, so that it is a this type of the dryer. Generally, polycarbonate sheet we have used in this type of dryer, and this capacity is the 450 kg per batch. It is one important technology, the cooking also very important, and we already I already discussed the clean cooking. The clean cooking is very important, so that solar cooker is also very important technique for the northeastern regions. This view of the solar parabolic this type solar cooker. See, the biomass energy, biomass is a huge biomass available in the agriculture sector, so that we can use the different technologies using the biomass conversion technology. The first one is the direct combustion. So we have developed the energy efficient double pot improved biomass cook stoves for the northeastern region, so that is the average thermal efficiency around 29% in major in the rural areas and the semi-urban areas. The major problem of the indoor air pollution, so that in we have tested in the improved biomass cook stoves, so that is around 89% of the less CO emission and CO2 3.2 time. Next technology is very important technology in the biogas technology. This technology is very important for the farmers. As an integrated farming, animal farming are there, so that we can use this tank for the getting the biogas, and the, we can get the simultaneously the biogas slurry. So that is the one technology also, biogas products from the kitchen waste. The farmers also we can use, and some semi-urban area we can use this type of the system. So that this system is also very important for the farmers. Some future strategies and policy recommendations for my side. This is need to promote the use of renewable energy technologies for the sustainable agriculture in NEH region. For example, like the solar water heating system, pumping system, dryers, improved cook stoves. Renewable energy technology can be used in agriculture in number of ways, saving money, increase self-reliance also, and reducing pollution. Nowadays, the energy Sauraj is also very important to think the localized solution to problems, to for training communities to generate, consume, maintain, manage their energy resources locally. Means the resource we have to use the local resource for the generate our energy. This is a self-sustained of the energy nowadays is very important. Need of design and development and location specific energy efficient renewable energy technology, it is very important. The reason is that the availability of the solar and the availability of the biomass, wind, etc. is that depends on the location specific. So that location specific energy efficient technology is very, very essential. The installation of the small scale renewable energy based projects within the agriculture business should be encouraged, and it will help in the combating in the climate change and improvement of the business viability. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Professor Rai. It was very good as you touched upon many aspects, including the government scheme for helping users in get subsidies, and then many rural aspects. Wind energy, you need to support limited level. Usually, in the hybrid areas, the velocity is more than 4-5 kilometers per hour. These are the three years. We thank you very much for the lively and the medical presentation. Thank you so much. Now, the next speaker, please. In case of micro irrigation technology for sustainable agriculture. Particularly, you also have 20 minutes. Again, if you have questions, you can finish and wind up in 15 minutes. So that it was. Otherwise, we'll take up the questions at the end. And my request to the audience is that.
Okay, sir.
Please reserve your questions.
and you can post all the questions.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Please start.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Sir, very good morning to all of you. Honorable Vice Chancellor, Central Agricultural University. Honorable B. Sir, Dr. K. K. Satpathy Sir, Dr. Shah Sir, the distinguished participants, other professors, scientists. I am Dr. G. T. Patle. Today, delivering my talk on integration of micro irrigation with rainwater harvesting for sustainable hill agriculture. From yesterday, we are discussing on the sustainable development of agriculture in the northeastern region. But we know that water is an important input for the agriculture, and the water demand is increasing day by day. And it is also expected that it will increase in future due to the climate change. Now, water being the powerful indicator of the ecological sustainability and economical prosperity in India, the region which have the high water potential, water availability, they are more prosperous, more sustainable, that is considered. And for that, effective management of the water is required for improving the crop productivity. But thing is that our low irrigation efficiency, it is the major concern. And that's why I am urging on the integration of the micro irrigation and water harvesting to achieve water, food and nutritional security. As we know that the climate is affecting our water resources, and in northeastern region, it is mainly in term of the precipitation pattern, the increasing crop evapotranspiration rate, surface runoff, groundwater recharge, drying up or spring. These things are the concern for our region. Now, why rainwater harvesting? It is essential with integration of the micro irrigation, because we have the lack of water harvesting, water storage and irrigation facilities. Why this is so? This is due to the steep terrain, shallow soil depth and dominance of the sand in the textures, because our infiltration rate is very high. And drying up spring in the winter is the main problem, which is the major source of the livelihood for irrigation. Instead of high rainfall, we are facing the water shortage facilities. And due to that, the minimum productions and productivity of our northeastern region is one of the major concerns due to the unavailability of the water. Because we are using the surface water as the main source of irrigation, which has very less water efficiency, which is reported at minimum 7%. This is very, very means less as compared to our different part of the country. Now, what are the different difficulties in managing the water resources in our region? We have a lot of difficulties. First is the undulating terrain. This is our the major difficulty, that our topography is such that key managing water resources is very difficult. Another, scattered land holding, means for providing the irrigation by the irrigation department through canals and other means, it is very difficult. Why? It is the scattered. Then steep slope, which exaggerate the our soil erosions and the water velocity. Lesser soil depth. Lesser soil depth, it is related to the less water holding capacity and less nutrient availability in the soil. Next is the high infiltration rate. We have measured that our infiltration rate in near about forest area, they are near about the 50%. Means 50% water is going to percolate and 50% is going to flow. That is also one of the cause. And poor irrigation structures. Now, what is the solution for that? The technological interventions. Yes, technology methods, they are available, but their proper application at the suitable place, that should be implemented. And for that, development and use of site-specific water management technologies, integration of the micro irrigation with the rainwater harvesting, especially for the horticulture crops, which are in northeast region. Now, what are the key factors for the water management? We should have the consider the different factors. First, the hydrology. Second is the topography of the region. Then climate. our climatic parameters, they affect our the crop water requirement, and according to that irrigation scheduling changes. That's why we have to thoroughly study of the climate and its impact on our water resources. Socio-economic condition of the peoples or the farmers. Why any technology or any system we are adopting, then it requires the money, involvement of the money. Either it is adoptable, it is feasible, that we have to see. Agronomical practices and the soil. Therefore, we need the efficient irrigation techniques, because our regions, though it is considered in the high rainfall regions, people, they said that there is no need of the irrigation, always we are getting the rain, but availability of the water at the proper place for the proper time is not feasible, and that is major concern for us. This we can see that for that our efficiencies are very less, but using the latest like the sprinkler, drip, and other type of the fogger technology, we can increase our water efficiency. Now, for efficient water management, there should be control on the application of the water. Then only we can increase the water efficiency. And this priority is given in the drip and sprinkler and other control systems like IoT-based systems. When to apply, where to apply, and how much to apply. Means we have to think for this thing, and we can schedule our irrigations for the proper place with the proper irrigation systems. Another thing is that to improve the water efficiency in our region, we have to see for the crop selection criteria. The crop requiring the less water according to the variety, according to the season, their growing period. Then irrigation scheduling. Scheduling is very, very important. Why? If scheduling is not there, we will either under irrigate or the over irrigate, and that will waste up our water, which is already in scarce. Then irrigation methods and the source and quality of the waters. These things we have to consider. This is the well-known technology all over the world. In our India, it has maintained, means affected very nicely, proven technology, but very effective for the plain topography. But in case of the hills, design and the field layout need to be changed for the proper utilization of such drip irrigation technologies. Now, already study has reported everywhere that we can increase our yield by the 20 to 65%, and we can save the 20 to 70% of the water using such technologies. Government of India is promoting the har khet ko pani or per drop more crop by PM KESWAI scheme, which is launched in the 2015, and the different the suggestive cost has been given for the like 1 hectare area, 2 hectare area, 3 hectare area, according to the spacing of the crops. Likewise, in the sprinkler irrigation, for 5x5 meter spacing, 3x3 meter spacing, we can means install the drip irrigation system, taking the assistance of the government of India and the state government subsidies. Now we have to mostly focus on the gravity drip irrigation system. Why? Our terrain is the slopy, which provide the pressure head for operating such type of the system. And this gravity drip irrigation system, it is an energy saving system. No need of the pump, no need of the power source. That's why we have to promote in our areas. Now, this is one of the developed system for the small area. We can operate such type of this gravity drip irrigation system for the 100 to 200 square meter area. And such type of the system can be used under the covered conditions in protected cultivation or under the open field conditions. Another type of the developed and tested systems at our CAEPHT means if we have the our terrain is 5 to 10% of the slope, then how our water distribution will take place? Why in drip irrigation, each and every plant should get equal and same amount of the water for the proper development of the crop. Otherwise, it will affect our yield. That's why already such systems, they have shown the good field efficiency, 70 to 80%, and which can be adopted at low cost by the farmers. And it requires hardly the 50 to 80 per square meter cost. Another proven technology is developed is the gravity drip irrigation system for the terrace field. Such type of the design of the drip irrigation system and installation on the terraces of our northeastern hill regions. They can save the large quantity of the water, and they are proven to increase the yield 40% to 50% for the different vegetable crops. And these are the affordable systems and subsidized system by the under PMKSY scheme. These are the some peaks of the demonstrations of the systems. We have demonstrated our systems by seminars in Nagaland under the benchmarking irrigation of the project seminars, and so many farmers, and really they appreciated, means system is under work for the hilly regions. Now we can decrease the cost of our gravity drip irrigation systems by little bit compromising with the quality of the materials, and such type of the low head, low pressure head systems at 1 meter tank height or maximum 2 meter tank height, they can also work. And this is the typical gravity drip irrigation systems by using the drums and the other things. This is the use of the integrated rainwater harvesting with the drip irrigations. Means we have to harvest the water from the polyhouses, and same water we have to use under the polyhouse for the cultivation of the crops, and it can save the 44.4% of the water for the tomato and the different crops. Now, properly designed drip irrigation systems can save the 30 to 60% water, increase the yield 20 to 50%, improve the quality of the produce, reduce the labor cost, and reduce the disease and the pest. Micro sprinkler also can work on the gravity pressures if we are capable to generate the pressure of the 1 to 1.5 kg per centimeter squares, and they are successfully operating for the close growing crops. Now, thing is that for installing the drip irrigation system, first thing is that we have to provide the water facility, availability of the water, and it can be happen through the rainwater harvesting. So major for our northeastern region, the rooftop rainwater harvesting using the slopy roofs of the houses, another is the slopy roofs of the polyhouses. And another, we can go for the surface runoff harvesting using the dugout ponds, gel ponds, or diversion bunds, etc. These are the design considerations for the rainwater harvesting systems. That is the, what is the rainfall catchment area, collection efficiency, tank volume, and what is the water demand. According to the water demand, we have to design the rainwater harvesting system and to provide the availability of the storage capacity. Components, I will not discuss much more. Now, this is one of the developed rainwater harvesting system for the low cost bamboo polyhouses. It has the rainwater harvesting potential of 200 liters in the month of the November, when we get the at least very less quantity of the showers, to maximum 32,000 of the water. And we know that for one crop, for example, the tomato, cauliflower, for one season, 32,000 liters of the water is sufficient for 100 square meter area or 150 square meter area. Means we can provide the life-saving irrigation, and if we can increase the storage capacity by the dugout ponds like 50,000, 60,000.
You have three more minutes, please. You can close your talk.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Hello. Such type of the means on bench terraces also we can install the different types of the rainwater harvesting systems. Other field conditions are the bunding, terracing, mulching, trenches. These can be soil water conservation techniques, both conserve the soil and conserve the water. For construction of the ponds, these are the different construction criteria, where main thing is that we have to decide for storage capacity and our demand, means requirement, which type of the crop and which season we are going to cultivate, so that that water will be sufficient for growing the crop. These are the some peaks which were such type of the small dugout ponds for the 30,000 to 40,000 liter capacity were installed with the collaboration with the Central Agriculture University and the ATMA in the Sikkims. And now these ponds, they are at the higher elevations, and this water can be provided by the either pipe with gravity or with the help of the gravity drip irrigation systems or the gravity micro sprinkler systems for the cultivation of the crops. So which higher elevation means we have to think for the farmers which are at the top. Why? They have only the source of water by conserving in terms of these such type of the small tanks. Lower side, we can harvest the water, we can collect the water, but at top level, we have to construct such type of the form so that water can be ensured. Now, these are the some suggestive policy interventions: development and management of the on-farm water harvesting storage structures, development of the rainwater harvesting structures for existing new polyhouses at the farmer's field, promotion and adoption of the micro irrigation for increasing the productivity and quality of high value horticultural crops, and they recommended that the integration of the gravity fed micro irrigation systems with rainwater harvesting system, either the harvesting water from the polyhouses at the individual farms or harvesting water by the help of the dugout line ponds for the ensuring water security and uplifting the livelihood of the northeastern farmers. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Patel. Very comprehensive, very detailed presentation. Many good points. I hope you will be included in the proceedings of this particular webinar. And you have raised many issues regarding joining the health system. Good means good
questions. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
And one more problem that you have highlighted is about spider insect, cause of which there is a problem, cause of which all landslides place in areas. We thank you very much for your presentation, and I hope we'll reserve more questions. For the end, I request the guests to put their questions on net, or they'd like to raise these questions at the end of all the investment. Thank you. We have Professor Majumdar. Professor Majumdar will be speaking on ethnic risk and need drugs or sustainability in specifically in northeastern region. Majumdar, please.
Sir, Dr. Majumdar is not joined.
Okay.
Dr. Joy Kumar.
Okay. So we have
Dr. Joy Kumar.
The next speaker, Dr. Joy Kumar. Yes.
Yeah, I'm here, sir.
Joy Kumar, if you start, you have 30 minutes again. If you early, will have also you on time, then resolve the question and please start.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello, Patel. Please remove your this slide.
Your audio.
Kumar, give projection mode.
It's only in a projected mode, sir.
No.
Okay.
Projection mode means a full slide.
Full screen.
PDF में खोल रहा है.
नहीं, PDF में खुल उसमें भी होगा.
So I press F, it is not coming. So is it coming in a full? Sir, this participants are raising, please mute this one, sir. Participants are raising their hands.
You start your presentation.
It's not coming in. Okay, sir, I'll just start. But very good morning, good afternoon to Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor M. Premjit Singh, and Dr. Vist, your former Vice Chancellor of the Jeevan University, and the chairman of today's session. and Dr. K.K. Satpathy, Professor Sahaji, and other panelist member. Topic actually I'll be talking is a challenge posed in especially in the processing as a result of COVID-19. And then what are the some possible solutions that I'll be talking today? Sir, why are these participants raising hand is coming, sir?
इसमें भी नहीं सुनाई पड़ रहा ना, ऐसे भी नहीं सुनाई.
Hello. Hello, am I audible, sir?
You are audible, sir.
Why these participant hands are coming up? Please control this one, sir.
Sir, don't ignore that thing.
Because it's been setting on my slides. Anyway, I'll be just continuing. Actually, the challenge is what we are facing because of COVID-19. So we have been talking about what are the problems that we have been facing so far because of even because you know that total lockdown caused the total no transport of agricultural materials from the that producers fields to the marketplaces, and on almost all the markets were closed. In fact, we know all this, what are the problems? So just to cite one example, what exactly the losses occur in Assam tea garden. Actually, I just read in a newspaper in some sources, actually they have already estimated a loss of 1,219 crores or rupees because of the COVID side, because their tea was supposed to be harvested. The fourth flush of the tea was supposed to be harvested from March, April like that. So because of this COVID, they couldn't do that. So such type of a big losses are occurring. Another thing is that because there are so many losses in Manipur also in the northeastern. In fact, a few farmers, what happened? They did not harvest watermelon as such, because though even if all the markets are closed and no buyers are coming, so even if they harvest also, there will be no facilities for storing it. Cold storage and the processing, lack of the processing. So because of all this problem, actually, all so many losses were there. Almost all the restaurants and then hotels closed down. So because of that, there was no demand of the milk. So definitely there's the milk farm, actually they had a very big problem. They could not sell their milk, and rather they did not know how to process also, and the value additions and all these things. There were no facilities, and because of that only there are a lot of losses in milk.
But your slide is not moving.
I'm just moving it myself. Is it moving now?
So can you moving from your left side? Some thumbnail is even showing. From the left side, you can move 1, 2, 3, 4 like that.
Oh, like this. Is it like this?
Still, it is not moving, sir.
Is there any changes now?
No, sir. Sir, I am accessing. I am taking permission from you from control my side. Please permit me.
Okay, fine. Approve.
No, sir. It is not working. You can continue, sir.
If the slides are not coming, then how can when the slides is not changing at all?
The Jay Kumar, you explained the picture very nicely. Maybe that slide under these circumstances cannot be required. You can close
and you can again start the PowerPoint.
Stop it, you are.
choose what
Just give me one second. Restart, sir. Jay Kumar ji, restart. Okay. Just rejoin.
Amtichelo yadre. Chelo yakhturo. Ai idelai re. Sir, give me just 1 minute. I'll do it.
Sir, what I am doing, I am stopping your sharing screen. And you can again share your screen.
Reshare.
New share is there.
1 minute, sir. 1 minute.
Jay Kumar, is it PDF file?
It's PDF file. Shall I share now?
PPT mein dekhao na. PowerPoint.
It's not
good. Now you can share, sir.
Okay.
The audience,
she's a full the
like, it's already
full the full
you may like your question and
sir
like
Hamidri Samidri is it changing
now? Yes, it is changing now.
Okay, is it changing now, isn't it?
You can fast, sir, for a little bit.
Okay, so now is it in the third slide, isn't it? Fourth slide,
yes, sir.
Okay, now I'll just continue with this. In fact, challenge is I have already talked. Actually, there is a big challenge for the flowers also. I'll just go a little fast because I wasted time. The flowers, actually, the problem is now, for the last years, even in Manipur, in the Northern Center, there is a huge demand of the flowers for the party and other things. So this time, actually, almost everything was locked down and no marriage, nothing was going on. So there was a heavy loss in the flowers. So this is one challenges we have seen. And another one, actually, as you know, the Northeastern state is a totally locked, landlocked area. So there is no industries, no factories, etc. Biscuit, demand for a biscuit and a noodle, etc. There was a huge problem. And then another very important challenges we faced was, so the challenge in the spice productions. In fact, spice productions usually is the spices, all these spices like chilies, cucumber, turmeric, these are harvested in a month of, in a Rabi season only. But somehow the lockdown started and then the last pickup of the spices crop was a leftover. So because of this, actually what happened, once the spices are harvested, we have to go for curing and we have to go for post-harvest processing. So we actually, when the time came for the processing and drying, etc., so there was no labor available. And then now we can expect that the spices, quality of the spices that we'll be getting from this will not be of a very good quality. So that is nothing, but it is a big losses as far as post-harvest losses are concerned. Now, after analyzing all these challenges, I'll come directly to the roadmap, how we can, there are some plausible solutions that we can do. Actually, the state government here also in Manipur. So what happened? The situation in Manipur is entirely different from what we see in all those mainland areas. Here, we are not producing our commodity in a large quantity. Then whatever the little quantity we are producing is that is producing. We are actually, in fact, distributing among, say, I mean, you know, 1 minute to say that it is not at all sufficient. So the government's target is just to grow more of a vegetable, whether it is highly nutritious or non-nutritious, things to be available to the people. So like that, government's target is grow more vegetable and do little processing and like that. This is a fast. Then we'll go to the second, when the rabi season comes, say probably in November to December, and then more vegetable again will grow. Then once all these COVID like situations, pandemic situations get settled down, then we'll talk about, we'll augment different processing technologies, new technologies. So this way our government is targeting. And then in order to produce more of this vegetable, in fact, we have more than 45% potential area for growth. I mean, for area for plantations. So now coming to directly the northeastern state, actually, our we are very rich in what they call it, in a few crops where we can extract, we can earn money ourselves. Our main objective for what they call like keeping ourselves sustained, earn money is from this few crops mainly, because as you know that the pineapple is one of the best pineapples available in northern states. We have mandarin, we have this, and ginger, turmeric. These are the UPS. This is the uniqueness of the northern states. Here only we have to target our productions, earn money, economy. Just to boost up our economy has to be done from this crop mainly. So just to give some idea about how. See, actually, the pineapple production factor, why I call this a unique pineapple productions we have, and these are the different properties. I'll go a little faster in this. I'll directly come to the application part, sir, because of the shortage of time. In fact, when I talked about, actually, when a situation, COVID-like situation comes, our main target, our solution, probable solution, plausible solution should be, say, a group of people, maybe on a small scale, home scale, what you call a processing has to be augmented. Say, for example, small scale thermodynamic processing. So what happened with the one or the two machines only, say, to the tune of maybe the 1 lakh. So because all the farmer, when such type of situation comes, every farmer cannot wait for the government subsidies, government's what do you call all this distribution and all that. So like maybe one or group or two, three families, they themselves can purchase, then such type of the small units can process themselves. It is for their sell consumption, not for a sale to other, sell to export it outside, nothing. Because in such type of pending situations, they themselves can process and then they can sell at the most to the local areas. Like that, this is one solution. Having one turmeric washer, then a slicer, then after drying, we go for the pulverizing, make it, and then later on a powder form. So like this, this is once. And then another, suppose we have different crops and we can't keep for longer period because there's the perishable. So to put a drying technologies, low cost drying technologies are also available at a very cheaper rate. So like that, solar cabinet dryer, solar working dryer, these are some of the options for the, what they call the storage, drying and storage of our crops in sustainable conditions situations. And we have another machines. These machines actually the non-electrified area. So when the electricity is not available in the rural areas, where the biomass is available extensively, I mean, is available easily, evidently. In those areas, sustainable machines, so like the biomass heat generated there, so this will help in the drying and storing our products successfully. So like this, we can go for the drying of king chili, we can go for the drying of turmeric, and then even a fish could also be dried. So that it is, as I told, it is for the self-sufficiency. We are not going to sell, export it outside because associations, we can't do anything. Only thing is that we have to keep ourselves self-sustainable. Then later on we packed it and then keep it for longer period or a sell. Another possibility of what we call a generating income ourselves is on a pineapple processing. As you know, the pineapple is one of the best quality available in Northeast, including Manipur. So here, from this itself, we can earn, we can generate income. How? So I'll be just telling some of the few slides. So what happened, say, for those who are doing the pineapple business, so for them, harvesting is a big problem. And we have a solutions for the harvesting of the pineapples. So like anybody, like if you are not, he's not very expert in harvesting, but this type of machines will help him to harvest so easily. That means no expert is required. So like that, in a pandemic situation, anybody, any layman people, normal people can do the harvesting. And then come to the processing, that is mini unit processing. So like at a small, say costing to the tune of 3,000, 4,000 rupees can do the processing, that is cutting, peeling, coating, everything can be done simultaneously. So this way is the processing. Suppose if he has to convert it into juice and other things, no. Such type of small tools will help definitely. And then another, osmodiahydrate, suppose if you have to convert and preserve our pineapple, but pineapple cannot be kept for a longer period. So that has to be dried, I mean, osmodiahydrated, and then stored for a longer period. In this way, this is such type of small tools will also help. So like that, small tools will be definitely useful for generating income ourselves in the local areas, in rural areas. So like, as I was talking about osmo dehydrated rings, we can go for tidbits, we can go for osmo dehydrated rings. Then another technologies we have in that, in a market actually, like a lot of juices are coming, bottle juice are coming up. But truly speaking, their bottle juice, these are all chemical preservative added somewhere or somehow. Because you know, we are in the northern states and we are very much conscious of what we call organic foods. So in that, without adding any preservative and to be very organic, so we have the technologies to prepare the juice directly without adding any preservative, can keep for 3 to 4 months definitely without any preservative. Do we have this technology? So even we have patented, we have commercialized this technology. Another, like that, we have given some training in the during pandemic system, you know, we have given some training and we have developed some entrepreneurs. So this one of the entrepreneurs in Imphal, Imphal East, we have trained them. Another situations, when such type of pandemic situation or any kind of a situation comes, when there shouldn't be more people working in the field, and then people cannot come from the rural areas to the city, what do you call marketplaces. In those situations, such as a mobile van, processing van, can go directly and do all kind of a processing, especially extraction of the juice, and then bring the juice or leave the juice for them. Just leave the juice if they want to convert it into some RTS or a square, something like that, we can leave. Only thing is that our intervention is we can do the extraction, leave them, and then thereby, so the whole, you know, say 1,000, 2,000 pineapples, say like that, suppose if the manual labors are required, so many people will be required. So for such type of mobile bank, say hardly 2-3 people can do all this process. So such type of mobile vans are very much necessary. In fact, this is for pineapple like that. Say in those areas where tomato is grown extensively and the tomato transportation is again a big problem. In those area, mobile tomato processing vans are also available. So like that, for reason wise, we'll have to select tomato processing, pineapple processing, and some other crop processing, reason-wise. So like that, such type of mobile van processing units must be popularized or must be given some attentions. And then, so this is what, and then that mobile van, actually, if they don't want their juice to be packed or processed, we can take this, or they themselves can come over here, bring, convert the whole juice into
a please.
Yeah, I'll go faster. And from the pineapple, since I told pineapples, we have a lot of pineapple and the leaves, etc. After the once pineapple is harvested, we have the technologies to convert. See the pineapple leaves. Actually, the once the pineapple is harvested, they fill. So this could be converted into the fiber form with this all. And this fiber, actually, truly speaking, this is a fiber, it's so costly. And in the international market, it will be in the dollar forms. So forget about money. So like that, we can generate incomes out of this. Another utilization of pineapple waste for animal feed making. So this is another very burning. So definitely, Northeastern states, we cannot forget about meat. We cannot forget meat. Say, for example, maybe buffalo or maybe what do you call a pig. From a pineapple waste, these are one of the best, the waste product from which we can go for the partial fermentation of these leaves, all these peels, etc. And it can be directly fed to the pigs, because this is considered to be the one of the best food for the pig. So like that, the stuff of technologies will definitely help for the upliftment or for rearing of this cattle, instead of depending all the time bringing this feed from outside the states, like that. Another technologies that I would like to mention over here is small scale animal feed making pilot plants. Say now, as I said, the poultry feed and the cattle feed. Okay, cattle feed I have already solved, but poultry feed and then this dairy, etc. There are feeds actually. So we have now government is also targeting in the production of the more of the mazes. So by putting 3-4 this is small scale machines, say for example selling machine of the maize, then we put it maize grinding machines, then go to the mixing, and then finally pelleting. So like that, and then add another machines like oil expelling machines. I'll be showing it later. So like by 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 machines all together in one room, we can produce very good quality animal feed, so that we will be self-sufficient and animal feed will not depend from maybe Guwahati, maybe any Kolkata, etc. So like that, we have the technology. So in this way, we have to target. Another thing, so like the farmers, they find a lot of difficulty because before they could transport, shift their material from the field to the suddenly lockdown, suddenly sustainable bunch happens. Then zero energy cold chamber is one of the options. So how it is constructed and all, I'll be just showing you. So like that, it's a very simple construction, maximum cost 12,000 only for this much capacity. So thereby we can keep our produced at least for the 10 days or 15 days, at least 1 or 2 weeks extension, or this is more than sufficient for the sustainable associations. So like that, zero energy cool chamber, it is another options for. And then in those areas where the bamboo shoot, it is what I call it, grown extensively there, we will give this sort of a machine over here, that is bamboo shoot peeling machines. This will peel like this, and we can convert a different value added products in this way. So this is way also, we will not depend from any other, we will, whatever bamboo shoot is available extensively, so we will produce ourselves and we'll consume. We will not depend from outside during sustainable pending situations.
You may like it now.
Sir, I'm winding up within 1-2 minutes. And then this makhana processing, it is one unit here. Another, apart from that, this one, from a different fruits available now, we can convert into either pickles, ladder, etc. And then this one. See, nowadays, I was talking, sir, when a pandemic situation came, there was no sale of the milk in a restaurant and hotels. In this way, home scale, a person can convert, because of the keeping this milk as such is not good. They can convert into paneer in this fashion. And then we have another technology for converting our black center, because our Manipur has called a GI for this one. We have the different value added product from this. In this way also, whatever produce we do from our state, and we can generate income ourselves. So these are the different products. And then finally, sir, another recommendation, I'll come directly to the recommendation. So the development of the low cost storage, it is very important. And then before we go for consumption, we have to go for washing. Domestic processing, Development of domestic labeling process equipment. So this is one very important. We have to, government has to give major thrust in this level, the domestic level kind of. Minimum support price of the financial should be done, and more processing startups should be initiated. And then, as I told, mobile processing ban for a different commodities should be increased. And then lastly, because since we have India, you know, we are at the border of India, so we'll have to link up and transport our all produce to the other South Asian countries also. So that's all I have to speak in this. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Joy. It was very interesting, and you have explored many kinds of options for value addition of eligible produce at level. You have USP of given us that apple, oranges, mandarins,
yes,
chilies, ginger of the high value, which could be after processing we exported. Cool chambers at a local level, you have touched upon. Maybe the details be available to participants. Mobile vans, mobile cool vans, also you have to step on, which is very important. From your presentation, it is clear that we have large number of technologies developed for a small scale holder and small entrepreneurs and medium entrepreneurs. But how many of these have to destination that should be seen? And how many of these have been commercialized that has also been seen? Our value addition at present to agricultural commodities, including horticulture and milk and meat products, etc., is very low as far as international standards are concerned. We have to have at least 3 to 4 times increase in every commodity the value addition. Only then it will be possible to generate enough employment in rural areas and also to give remunerative price to the farmers and the local entrepreneurs. Thank you for your presentation. The last one we have is Dr. Pragati Hazarika. Dr. Pragati, are there? She'll be talking about on new addition of livestock and fish products. She is from College of Veterinary and Animal Sciences Museum, Central Agricultural Embassy. Dr. Pragati, you are welcome. You may start.
Full screen. Sir, is it visible, my slide?
Yes.
It's visible.
Your slides are visible. Very clear. Your voice is also very clear. No problem.
Thank you, sir. So a very good afternoon to all the members present here in this webinar. Honorable VC Sir, Professor M. Premjit Singh, the chairperson of today's session, Dr. B.S. Beast, and all the learned members present over here. I am Dr. Pragati Hazarika, working as assistant professor in the Department of Livestock Products Technology in College of Veterinary Sciences and Animal Husbandry. Now, my topic today is adding value to livestock products. So previously, speakers have put out their views regarding the post-harvest technologies and how value-added sector can be an option to provide the sustainability of different agricultural produce as well as benefits to the farmers. I will not elaborately discuss on that side. Rather, I would like to describe how value-added sector, value-added industry sector can be propagated. What are its prospects? Now, we often hear that value-added. Now, what is this value-added means? Adding value means it is just a raw product by which we can take it to at least to the next stage of production. Suppose it, as because I am a person of livestock products technology, so my focus will mainly be on the livestock products. Now, suppose a chicken, if we just dress it and just pack the things in a proper hygienic way, cut up parts, different parts, if we can take, that also means a value-added product. And one step ahead, we can go for processing of those cut up parts, and then either sterile packaging, or maybe with an option that it can be stored in a refrigerated storage. Whatever, a further step towards the next stage, we call it as value-added. We will add some value in the means of different components. Maybe it is for reducing the time of preparation, or maybe adding some extra nutrients to the meat, to not only meat, all the livestock products. I mean, maybe meat, maybe milk, maybe egg, or maybe the byproducts of the livestock industry. Now you see a value added, which means further processed products. Now, what does it do? It decreases the preparation time. It minimizes the preparation steps, which is very much useful in today's day-to-day fast lifestyle, especially in the urban areas as well as in the metropolis. People are going for it because it minimizes the preparation steps, use of specific parts, then taking risk out of the kitchen. You see that if we bring a chicken or maybe whatever, we take to the kitchen and do it ourselves, the risk in this era, we now know how much is the risk of taking the things into the kitchen. Now, it usually takes the risk out of the kitchen. How? By hygienically processing the products. Moreover, smaller lures, nowadays we have to register whatever the food processing entrepreneurs or the processors are doing. They usually have to register the FSSAI. We know they are recommending different standards for the products. Next thing is, it increases the value of the product. It may incorporate fiber. You see the meat which we relish, the Northeastern people, we cannot think with a meal without meat, fish, or whatever livestock products. Now, meat is a zero fiber food, we can say, but we cannot avoid it, as because it is zero fiber. Now, what we can do, we can incorporate fiber into it to increase the value of the product, and moreover to feed to our kids, our children. The pathetic condition is that if we see, I am considering only the meat industry. Now you see the India's meat production now, as per FAO 2020, is approximately 7.3 million tons, which is approximately only 3% of the total world production of 333 million tons. And out of that 7.3 million tons, only 2% of the meat is processed for value-added meat products. Only 2% of the meat. Now, there are many bottlenecks. There are many things for which this processed meat sector is not flourishing properly. But even then, it is still in an infant stage, we can say. It is still, because hardly a few enterprises are giving its step towards the processing of meat. Whereas you see in the developed countries, 60% of the total meat products, total meat is processed for value-added meat products, 60%. And that's how a nation can step towards development or flourish in the livestock industry. Efficient utilization of livestock products, it not only helps in sustained livestock production, but it also improves or creates livelihood generation, as well, I mean to say, the employment generation, and very importantly, food and nutrition security of the consumers. Now, while going towards this value-added food sector, two questions are to be answered. One is, what is customer value? And next is, what creates a value-added product? So whenever any entrepreneur is interested to set up a processed livestock processed food industry, these two questions are to be set in mind. Then only, that's why, without discussing anybody, without taking the view of the expert, if someone goes directly for this evaluated products industry or plans, it may not be a successful one, because the key points, what are the points to be taken care of, that has to be well informed to the entrepreneurs as well as to the farmers, to the processors. Now, what is customer value? It reflects the relationship between the benefits, what the customers will get from the commodity towards which they are paying the price. What will be their benefits? And if the price is, gap is more, if the price what they pay is less to the benefits what they receive is high, then it denotes a higher customer value. Now, it doesn't mean that the price should be very low for that. No, it is not the thing. Price may be high, but comparing to the price, the benefits what they receive is also high. So that is the customer value. Now, creating a customer value is not very easy. It is very critical. The customer should be well informed, aware of the product, what is developed. So before developing or marketing or going for a product, one has to create this customer value amongst the consumers. Second thing is value-added product. What creates a value-added product? These are the points. You see, quality. Customers will expect something. If they buy by paying, obviously the livestock products will not be very cheap. They will be paying something. Now, whether the expectation could be met or not, the functionality is proper or not, the form is useful or not, the place where the product is placed, whether it is the right place or not. Not only the place, the time also. Pardon?
Please go ahead.
Okay, sir. Now, not only the place, but it's the time also. Right time and right place. And ease of possession, whether the product is easily possessed or the consumers can easily have the products or not. What's driving the value-added sector? Next thing. Yes, the agribusiness, particularly the food sector. It's rapidly consolidating and increasingly responding to the consumers. Nowadays, you know, the consumers, they need the variety, they need quality, they need the service, they need the health benefits. Consumers are now aware of the social consciousness, increased value of the product, everything. In a nutshell, we can say that the consumers are nowadays very much value conscious. So while designing this one, we have to take care of all these things. And yes, of course, the consumers are very much after the value-added meat, value-added livestock products. Now you see, while from these value-added meat products, what are the benefits get observed obtained by the consumers? The variety, there will be lots of, usually when we go for a particular product, in case meat, maybe milk, maybe egg, what we can do directly if we purchase the product, we will go for a simple dish at home. But if we go for the processing of the
farm, madam, show your products.
Pardon, sir.
It's your not products you show.
Okay. So I am coming to it, because in our department, I will be focusing only on those things which we have developed in our department as well as through projects and from the research works. Those things I am coming. So the benefits, the most benefited thing is that already other speakers have already told that a post-service technology or a regular offtake to the farmers in a situation like COVID-19 also, because these process products can be stored for a prolonged period, that we come to know. So hopefully people will go for these value-added structures. Now coming to the products developed in our college, we have developed with simple technology, which can be very easily followed by the farmers as well as entrepreneurs. The most popular product over here in Mizoram, Aizawl, we call it an ethnic product, that is Voxarep. It's a dried meat product. Now here what happens, this picture shows how it is produced. It is just without standardization, without adding any spice. This is a widely accepted product over here in Mizoram. Now what we have done, some intervention, this is the traditional one, and we have applied a perfect formula for it by adding some ingredients so that the appearance as well as taste is prolonged, as well as the shelf life is prolonged, that this can be easily deliverable to the entrepreneurs. Second thing, we have also worked on this low fat means chicken sauces by using a preservative, but this is a food grade preservative widely used in 100 countries of the world, Nissin. So it is a bio preservative we have used for low fat minced chicken sauces. And then a shredded pork pickle, which is very much acceptable in the northeastern states, especially Nagaland, Manipur, and then Aizawl also. And this is self-stable. We don't need any kind of preservation technologies. We can keep it in room temperature, and it is very much suitable for incorporation in any type of fast foods. Now, one more thing is Voksha Vun. This is again a traditional product, and we have given some points and some intervention to modify it, and it is again a self-stable product. And a byproduct is efficiently used to make a snack. It is the pig skin, which is modified, and it is a self-stable one, and can be packeted. Ordinary packaging will do. It will not be spoiled in room temperature also. This one we have developed in our laboratory. Now we have again worked on enrobed meat products, which means giving a covering. We have used some naturally available, perennially available antioxidants like curry leaves, which is widely used all over India, and we all know it has some properties. Of course, the properties are well documented by other researchers, but not by me. But we have used and have seen tremendous potential towards the preservation capacity of these leaves powder. Then orange peel powder we have used for enrobing the meat products. Then we have used a culture, Lactobacillus sake, a protective culture, by which we can biopreserve the chicken breast fillets. By spraying it, it enhances the shelf life, storage ability of the product. Then again, bamboo shoot, which is very widely and our very liked thing. We have incorporated bamboo shoot in smoked chicken sausages and have found a very good result from the panelists that it is tasting good. It has increased fiber content as well as shelf life is also increased. And the most important thing is the cost of production is lower if we can use this easily available material in our product. Then one thing is chicken nuggets and patties where French bean and chickpea flour, both the things. India is abundantly producing both the thing. So we have incorporated these things in a I had a project on this and successfully could develop these products. Then for marinating chicken breast fillets, we have tried organic acids and could see that these acids can enhance the shelf life of the products. So all these things, antioxidants incorporated momos, we have tried this. Then self-stable meat products like pickle. This is the best thing we should say, because no, nothing we need, we can just pack it and then we can go for marketing. So these are the simple, with simple technologies, all these things do not require elaborate hi-fi equipments for processing. So in our capacity, we have tried to develop all these things, and still three students are working on three new technologies. Now, these are the things actually I want to tell, to convey to the entrepreneurs, that the operation plan, the personal plan, the sales plan, what are the strengths, what are the weakness, resources, and what are the planning of the
cash. Dr. Pragati, you can tell if there are some startups who have done, who have adopted your technology.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I'm coming to it. This one. I say this value-added lifestyle product is not just a media hype, but it is not impossible. She is one of our students, Vanram Limpui. She has proved it. She is now successfully running a meat processing industry here in Aizawl, and she is awarded by the Ministry of Skill Development and Entrepreneurship last year in the woman category. And she, her processing industry is Zonu Meat Processing Private Limited. Per month, approximately 1 lakh is the profit, she is saying to me, as per her comments. So she is Vante, our student. We are proud of her. She has successfully is running this program. Then one Malko is there in Aizawl for milk. That is a cooperative, of course. And then in Shillong, it is the meat treat. This is again a process meat industry where everything is available. Now coming to Arohan, it is in Assam. Choice under the brand name of Choice Pork Nestle, India's only pork-centric food processor with operations across 40 cities and 500 outlets. They are doing extensively good work. Sausages, salamis, everything. And tremendous employment generation is given by them. To conclude my lecture, I will say that large scope and need for development of livestock product sector to produce value-added products to benefit the farmers, producers, food processor, entrepreneurs, as well as the consumers, is the need of the hour. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Bish sir,
Shall we start?
Sir, please wait.
What we say?
Sir, I think Dr. Bist is lose the connection. So
hello?
We can
I think our chairman, I think connection mein nahi hai. Isme nahi hai. Disconnect ho gaya. So I request Dr. R.K. Mojumdar, Professor, College of Fisheries, Head and Department of Fish Processing and Engineering, you can start the your presentation.
Yes,
I think I am audible.
So unmuted, hoy na?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Honorable Vice Chancellor, Chancellor University Imphal. Honorable Chairman of the session, respected members and other participants. Myself, Professor R. K. Mojumdar from College of Fisheries. I am heading the Department of Fish Processing Technology and Engineering. The College of Fisheries Lembusara.
My topic is ethnic thing, since it is related to north, so all know about the northeast. So geographically, northeast India, its area is 2.55 plus square kilometer. Population is about 47 tribal groups. And religion Hindu, Muslim, Christian, Buddhist, and it the northeast shares about 2,000 kilometer of border with the Bhutan, China, Myanmar, and Bangladesh.
I got it connected now.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes. Shall I continue?
Please wait, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now, northeast tribes. There's some.
Hello.
Yes.
Hello. Yeah, we were there. We informed and used position. Product from India, we are only processing 2.5 total words. And that's very, very low. Whereas it is clear that our cattle for itself is more than about 50. So it is a low processing, the low value addition as far as animal products are concerned. Our production itself is in the world, but in processing very low, very low. The product-related products and quality considerations are important, and our fourth generation products is going to be highly competitive as far as the quality is concerned. Price packaging. And secondary order. Aspect. You have Mr. Audio. Things like that you like animal sector and then lab grown meat also and I will look more as on starters to motivate the starters any takes of these technologies we have thank you very much and we appreciate your presentation very thank you so much. Now, questions from audience are requested and invited. The moderator, Mr. Sudhir, please coordinate how the questions are for the audience, how these are made to the experts for their feedback and for their please. Please, can you make please?
Sir, our next speaker also joined. Sir, Professor R.K. Mazumdar can continue their presentation.
Yes. So, shall I start?
Yes, sir.
Start. Yes. Our Northeast tribes, they belong to Indo-Mongoloids, Tibeto-Burmese, all the tribes are having their own. Yes.
Please, what we do is we come first, then we take your presentation in time for your presentation.
What yes. First,
the audience and what is related to. Coordinators are expected to take questions.
Sir, actually one speaker is left. So
lot of students later on. Let a few questions be taken up. We'll invite it later. Hello.
Sir, one speaker
hello,
is left.
Questions, please.
Sir, theory. One.
We'll invite him later. Hello.
Sir, one speaker is left, sir. Professor R.K. Mazumdar, he can continue. Sir,
no questions. Mr. Mazumdar, how will you like to you?
Yes.
Dr. Mazumdar.
Yes, thank you, sir.
Yeah, please. You have to go. And please copy your presentation in advance so that yes. We have an question and answers.
Next members, our Northeast tribes, they belong to Indo-Mongolians, Proto-Australians, and all the tribes are having their own distinct culture and unique cultural identity. They are different. All the tribes are they have difference in their food culture, their taste, flavor, their rest, their rituals, their all the cultures, and almost all the tribes they are fond of non-vegetarian food and fond of spice. So our ethnic population of the Northeast India, they lead an intimate life with the nature, and it is in perfect harmony depending on the forest and environment surrounding them. The Northeast region is said that it is a cultural bridge between India on one side and Southeast Asia, China, Inner Asia, and Burma on the other side due to ethnic and linguistic angles. So these are the Northeast tribes. They are all but there are difference in their dress, even their cultures, even their rituals, even their language, food habits. Northeast, you know, it's a biodiversity hotspot. And Northeast is the hub of several traditional knowledges. And the traditional knowledges and biocultural diversity are intermingled with each other in the Northeast. And most of the, and the, this traditional knowledge of the Northeast are the women's are the actual stakeholders of this traditional knowledge of the Northeast. And they are the custodians. And this traditional knowledge are related to food, medicine, even so many other, mainly food and medicine, even the cultural system. You know, this Zoom culture system is available in, only in the Northeast. Then to some extent, just climate of the Northeast. Climate of the Northeast is humid and rainy. And in any place of the Northeast, the minimum rainfall is just more than 1,000 millimeter. And Cherrapunji, you know, this is the world highest rainfall zone is located in the Northeast. Food habits of the Northeast, since the food habits of the Northeast is very important, I can say what they do not eat. What they do not eat. There is nothing they do not eat in the Northeast. So food culture is almost similar to the Mongoloid culture of the Southeast Asian countries, because it is said that the Mongoloid people, they need more iron in their blood because they are staying at the high altitude where oxygen pressure is low. So they need a good source of iron, and this meat, and that means non-based products as a good source of the iron. And to meet the demand of their meat, the varieties of non-conventional meats like mithu, nyok, deer, rabbit, dog, jackal, monkey, tiger, bear, elephant, rhinoceros, snakes, mongoose, frog, tortoise, etc. They are consumed regularly, although these are wild animals and not permitted to kill under the Wildlife Protection Act. So regarding fish, about 180 to 266 species of freshwater fish, including considerable number of ornamental fishes, are reported in the Northeast. And annual average fish production in the region is 0.34 MMT. And other than fish also, here people also consume this cuchia, this freshwater eel, Amphipnus cuchia, and also the mussels, different types of snails, bivalves. A small indigenous species, that means SIS of the freshwater fish, it contribute a lot in the nutrition of the ethnic population of the region. Because Northeast, it's a, there's a huge amount of the low-lying area. And fish fermentation technology, it is unique in the Northeast. And it is evolved, it has been evolved due to compulsion of the people, because Northeast is the highest rainfall zone. Once during monsoon, there was a huge catch of the small indigenous varieties of fish like Puntias, Isomas, Amliphoningoton. But the dying was also not possible due to continuous rain and humid climate. There was no good road communication, not a non-availability of any ice or other sophisticated fish preservation method. So fermentation was the only alternative to the fishermen to preserve the fish for the lean period. So therefore, the Northeast region is bested with many fermented fish products such as chidol, nari, hentek, lona ilis, tang trap, etc. Now, there are number of fermented fish products are prevalent in the Northeast. So And one uniqueness is that the shidol or nari is the most popular fermented fish products in the Northeast, but it is salt free. It is salt free fermented fish product. But if you see in the Southeast Asian countries, all the fermented fish products are salted. So it indicates that this technology or shidol technology or nari technology has originated before people started using salt. So other similar, this nari, the almost similar type of product of the shidol is available in the Manipur. Then hantek, it is a mixture of the plant and fish, small varieties of fish. It is a paste type of product available in the Manipur. Then tangtaf, it is available in the Jayantia Hills. It is also fermented and semi-fermented fish product from the small indigenous fish. Then namsing, it is made by the missing community of the Assam. Here, small varieties of fish and along with the plants, they are made powdered and fermented in a bamboo cylinder for 30 days. Then dangpuitu, it is a fermented or traditional fermented meat fish products of the Mizoram state, where small variety of fishes are used. And they are first sun-dried and ground to paste and then fermented in the earthen container. The napti, it is another fermented fish product made by the Chakma community of the Tripura district. So Tripura state, that they use different types of dried fishes, small variety of dried fishes, and they fermented in the cemented tank. Then fermented hilcha, this is only the salted fermented fish. Where the hilcha, you know, is a very costly fish and very high fatty fish. Minimum fat is 15% is the average fat content in their just before spawning season. So these fishes are fermented in the brine. Then it is a very popular product. Then there are so many traditional beliefs regarding the medicinal value of this fermented fish product. It is said that the regular consumption of shidol is believed to improve the immunity against the malaria. You know, the Northeast is a malaria prone area. The nari is considered as a strong appetizer and believed to have therapeutic properties against the seasonal illness. Hence, it is offered to the convalescents and the and it has a many nutritional value. The tangtaf is believed to have many medicinal values against the seasonal illness. Then pattern of consumption of fish in the Northeast. Present per capita consumption of fish in the Northeast is around 9.18 kg as compared to the national average 13.13 kg. And on an average, more than 90% of the population of the Northeast are fish eaters. And other than fresh fish, dry, fermented and smoked fishes are equally preferred. Canned fishes are also in demand in the Manipur, Mizoram and the Meghalaya. And other than fresh fish, they also prefer this shellfish. Yeah, even frogs and this freshwater eel, kuchia. Now, smoked fish is in the Manipur, it's a hub of the different types of smoked fish, and it is very popular in all the families. It's one of the regular diet or regular menu in that diet. So, almost all varieties of fish, small to medium, they are smoked and they are having their different local names. But smoking is done in a very crude manner. So fish grilling takes place in the Meghalaya, in the Jayantia Hill. There is, see here the picture, how the fish is grilled in the open flame. Now traditional meat products of the Northeast India or ethnic meat products, they are mainly the smoked pork, beef, yolk, or the dried and fermented products. So these are the some products of the Northeast. Suppose kerioging, it's made from the yolk meat. Then it is stuffed into the intestine of the sheep. Then sachus, these are the different ethnic meat products. The sukhaku masu is the most popular fish meat products of the Darjeeling Hills and the Sikkim, where red meat or that means buffalo chabon is cut into threads and it is mixed with the spice and then hang under sun or smoked for drying. And yak chalu, the yak fat is put into the sheep's stomach, stitched, and it is hang for the future use and kept over the kitchen. And yak curry, this is the product of the leptas of the Sikkims. Pieces of yolk intestine is used. Then chatrasaya, a traditional goat meat product of the Bhutias. Then gama or jima, a traditional meat sausage of the made from the chabon meat or the goat meat in the Kumayam area. Then ariza, it is a traditional meat sausage made from the chabon meat. Then Don Assam, basically pork sausage made by the Khasi community of the Meghalaya. then smoked meat, pig meat of the Mizoram and Meghalaya. These are different types of smoked meat with first, sometimes it is partially dried before, then or directly smoked. Sometimes more spices are added. These are the different ways of smoking, but these are very crude manner. The smoked meat of the Arunachal Pradesh. Then these are the traditional smoked meat product of the Manipur state. Then Jantha, Guanghai Kang, Jaitin, these are sausage type of product. The traditional Naga meat products, even insects, different worms, so they also smoke it. Then traditional pork products of the Assam, there are different types of traditional pork products, mainly the smoked and dried products, and some are fermented also. And what is the perspective? Almost all the meat products, ethnic meat products, have a good demand even in the entire Northeast, even outside the Northeast also, and even to some Southeast Asian countries. So present status of the ethnic meat and fish products, the unique non-vegetarian food culture of the Northeast India evolved due to compassion, the processing of this food associated and their dynamics, their mechanism of transmitted from generation to generation and exchange within the and between the communities. But the processing of this meat products, fish and meat products are very traditional and is done in a very crude manner. No hygiene, no sanitation, no government supervision on the quality. And in most of the cases, there is no laid down standards from the, either from the BIS or from the FSSAI. The process of fermenting food, of course, it increases the shelf life and it increases the organoleptic properties and increases the nutritional and nutraceutical potential. But so many adulterations are also going on side by side to improve the shelf life by using pesticide, insecticide, and some report has already come. So although there are beneficial role of many of the products well known by the scientific community, but adequate scientific intervention is still lacking. With the metamorphosis of the society, the traditional knowledge need adjustment to the newer technology, understanding and reworking and incorporating of new technologies into their own practice.
But two more days.
Yes. Yes. So in Northeast India, yes, sir. So now this present limitations for white commercial or ethnic meat products. What is the this present limitation? What I've realized and I've gathered information from the all that the lack of quality control and hygiene by the meat handler, lack of standardization and uniform protocol, lack of adequate logistics for scaling up to large production, lack of knowledge on proper packaging materials and transport system, lack of institutional support mechanism, lack of branding, lack of trademark, lack of market networking, lack of availability and accessibility of meat processing equipment and technical know-how to the processor, lack of training for skill development of entrepreneurs, lack of managerial and marketing skills. Now, export, there are so many export potential of the Northeast meat product. Even to support this export, one Northeast cell has been set up in the Department of Commerce, and the region has also got the support from the Export Development Fund. Further, the Northeast region is sharing so many international borders, which could affect. Yeah, since our ethnic meat and fish products are having the similar products are available in the other nearby states, Myanmar, Indonesia, Malaysia, Thailand, Vietnam, Vietnam and Philippines. So there is a good export potential of this product. And to export this thing, what is required to make the safe product? That means it needs hygiene production, attractive packaging, nutritional labeling. That must be there once if we think to go out this product from India to the other countries. And in this way, some startup has already started working on Arohan Foods at Guwahati and Meat Treat at Shillong. They have already started working in this line. Moreover, one app, this e-marketing is done by the Jiska. They are also marketing number of vegetable and non-based foods of the Northeast region. Some strategies I'm suggesting for the policymakers. First of all, proper showcasing will enhance potentiality of this ethnic meat and fish products for commercialization, which will help to convert local market to global industry, generate employment and self-sustainability in the region, enhance entrepreneurship development. But what are the prime requirements to grow in this sector? First of all, is the awareness of the Food Safety Standard Authority of India, FSSAI. FSSAI should intervene so that safe product can be made, because under the GATT agreement, the product should comply so many microbiological and biochemical parameters to take it to the export level. The skin and entrepreneurship development, training, handholding, technical backup, etc. Branding and trademark, most important, because Sidal Nari is our branded product. So trademark can be easily put. The GI tag and identity of the competitive market, it will improve the marketing efficiency and market networking, establish linkage with the marketing agencies, market expansion, etc. So with this, thank you all. Now welcome to the Northeast India. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Majumdar. Very interesting presentation. You have listed a large number of these products and deep products which are being traditionally processed and produced in the Northeast. But however, what we see is that value has not been realized. And also, you talk about quality standards which are not being there. There is no standard protocol for production of these products. And hygiene and necessity. Also, food and hygiene aspects have been covered by you. Thank you. And these have to be built if we have a feed in the global market. Now, you listed also some of the weaknesses, which is last 30 years, 50 years, we have been living these weaknesses. But the solution is taking to now we have to seriously look at particular aspect. If historically we have been repeating weaknesses, so what is that? We have to do this work as elimination of weaknesses and gap is current. Marketing of opportunity is a key marketing of the new area which is being written successfully in artists, there are several steps which are getting good benefit of marketing. They are marketing locally, less than models. In reality, your content was interesting, clear. Thank you very much, Dr. Kumar Majumdar. Thank you. Now, questions, if there are some questions. I just made two more questions and so that are answered by the experts. Some have been collected or the audience listeners. Yes, please. The audience, I see more than 200 participants in this particular webinar. Out of that, at least 10 should have a question. We have 10 minutes left.
Sir, we are allowing some candidates to ask the question.
Yes, yes. Please.
1 minute.
Sir. Yes, please. Go ahead.
Saikat Vishwas.
Asis, you want to ask some question or you to reply?
So Saikat Vishwas want to ask the question.
Yeah, please introduce yourself from which university or from which company you are in. You are from. Yeah.
Saikat Vishwas.
Mr. Vishwas, please raise your question. Or comment.
Sir, actually he put his question in the comment box and Dr. P.K. Bora also gave the reply. So, but still we want that he can also ask the question in the live mode. But he is not here, I think.
Welcome. Okay.
So we may request from another participant also.
Any other participant? Any other audience? Anybody else?
Mr. Vipendra
could
Kumar.
Be a student or a teacher.
Yes, sir. Mr. Vipendra Kumar.
People from anyone from industry who is doing his business or her business in the area of agricultural machinery or maybe post-service technology valuation or import export of goods. Anyone?
I think, sir, they don't want to ask the question.
I would like to mention one question.
Okay. Yes, please. Yes, you are welcome.
So did I'm Sudhir Kumar from a scientist from ICR IAPR Kanpur.
Sudhir, one minute. Sir, before that, I want to ask one question from Dr. Pragati Hazarika, madam. She discussed about the antioxidant stable momos. So whether antioxidant is stable at the higher temperature, so how this antistable oxidant momos is prepared? Means something, ma'am, can you put light on that?
Actually, what happens, the work is still going on. It is not finished, still going on. We are working on that. And not easy to keep it stable at high temperature, the yes, antioxidants. It is not easy, but as because momos are not cooked at a very high temperature. And what we are doing that, we are cooking the meat beforehand, not within the momo. We are cooking the meat beforehand, and then we are mixing the antioxidants, and then we are steam cooking. So hopefully, so far, the activity is can be prevailed.
Okay,
that's what we are thinking.
Okay, madam. Thank you.
Welcome.
Now, Sudhir, you can continue.
Any other questions? Any other question? Sure.
Yeah, sir. It's an open question. Not for any specific person. My question is like in agriculture, we have a lot many products in different regions, but we have been very poor in branding the same. And so I would like to know that how we can proceed to do the branding of our products yes. as we do in other sectors.
Joy Kumar can answer.
Please complete your question or comment. Comment. Is it over?
Yes, sir. It's over, sir.
Yeah, you're right. I like to answer this based on my experiences that we have been very poor brand. Even the products we are processed minimal processed product. Even these need to be branded. And there are some examples that the experts gave about the different brands which are coming up. Northeast. Similarly, with marketing possible, it is likely that more number of products will be coming up with specialty areas and technology for processing. With this, I think some people may like to ask a few more questions. In meanwhile, I like to congratulate and thank Dr. Ayyappan. Who is Chancellor of the University, CAU. I also like to appreciate the effort of Dr. Jit Singh and thank him. Dr. Saha, Professor Sarpat was there with us and he was also the keynote speaker in this session. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. You had a very lovely presentation on agricultural machinery and related aspects in our days. Definitely, there is a need to improve the power input to the agriculture sector. Though that it will be very difficult to move ahead and pick that up what we have achieved. And we have a long way to go. And Professor Dilip Kumar Saab, thank you so much for being with us. We would have invited your comments. In fact, if you'd like to stop, I'd like to invite you for that. I also thank coordinators. All the participants, there are about 215 of them which are listed. All the participants and the audience, and then all persons managing this particular webinar. Thanks to Sudhir, Asis, Dr. Saran, and also all the experts, seven of them presented, and one keynote speaker, Dr. Sapati. So with IP that the webinar is complete, we will request some of you to from the university prepare the minutes of this particular important webinar. Many ideas have been generated. Your experiences will be of great help in your entrepreneurship. Any of them do not what the source of information for them, and how work had for example marketing, how to do it, where to do it, will be the form, what will be the scopings, and what the demand comes, we how to meet the demand. For example, in Northeast, the demand comes from Udaipur, maybe Bombay. So what you do to supply the products on time without PASA quality in proper order to Mumbai market. Now, similar kind of, there will be many issues which need to be sorted out. The banks are willing to offer, Prime Minister, Finance Minister announced scheme of about 20 lakh crores of rupees out of that. Maybe 1 or 2 lakh crores of rupees are available for food sector, processing sector, for agriculture, GNB sector. This can be made use. And this is probably the possible time to make these theoretical and laboratory studies actualized in the field in commercial form, in commercial words. So the endeavor which comes there releases, my estimate is that at least 20% of them will not go back. We like to remain involved in their itself. How to make use of these migrants? Most have got good experience elsewhere. They are going to bring you newer ideas, better energy in feed. Let them go back. Let all not go back. Let at least 20-30% of them should remain. How can they remain in the village? How to utilize that talent? Also, they need to have a large population of young people, educated people, very educated people. How best to utilize that talent, energy, skills, and their enthusiasm into business positions in the city sector for increased productivity and business options for the cost of production and for enhancing the technology level in rural areas and neighborhoods, as well as the food processing sector. How add value? What could be the position? In universities and ICI institutes, a lot of work has been done. A lot of technologies are available. About 2,000 technologies are available. How to make them and convert them into commercial business forms that has to be seen by us. So the responsibility lies with us, educators, researchers, the government officials, extensions, young people, NGOs to do that particular side. Thank you so much, and thanks again for giving opportunity to all of us for and this very valuable webinar. Thank you.
Hello.
Hello.
I think.
Yeah. A very good afternoon to everyone. Honorable Vice Chancellor of CAU Imphal and all the members of CAU family and all the delegates attending this webinar on strategies and policy interventions for development of agriculture in Northeast India. So now we are almost in the end of this third session of second day of this webinar on opportunities in agriculture engineering and post-harvest technology in COVID era. And in this 3 hours long session on this aspect, we had a long discussion as well as an insights on various aspects from different experts and speakers regarding farm mechanization, which is a need of the hour, and that is going to have a significant impact after this COVID era. Then natural resource conservation, which is of much significance to sustain the agriculture and to utilize the renewable sources of energy, and much emphasis on the solar energy. and then to increase the water efficiency by using different micro irrigation technologies in northeastern India. And after all this, when the crops are harvested and different products are harvested, we have to focus on the post-harvest technology. And much insight has been given on how to handle the food, how to process it, how to retain the quality, and how to ensure the safety and sanitization. And a lot of insight was also provided on the livestock products. It's a value addition, which not only increases value and marketability, but also decreases the risk and time, which is required for the cooking and making it available on the table. And a lot was discussed about the fermented fish products, smoked meat products, and its medicinal value. So as we all know that the Northeast India has its own unique cultural identity, both ethnically and linguistically. And it is one of the diverse mega biodiversity hotspot, not only in India, but across the globe. So seeing this importance, I think this was a much needed session, which was to be discussed on how to develop the agriculture by seeing the importance of agriculture in Northeast India, as well as focusing on the challenges which is going to come after the COVID era. So I think after looking at all these things, there is much need to create awareness among different stakeholders in agriculture and to do the skill upgrading, to increase the market linkages and to do the branding of the products, as well as to focus on the entrepreneurship development and quality and standard of food. So with these words, I think it's a high time. I would like to extend my vote of thanks. And for this, at our outset, first of all, I would like to extend a vote of thanks to Dr. B.S. Bistsa, former Vice Chancellor of Govind Vallabh Pant University of Agriculture and Technology, Pantnagar, a very well-known personality, whom I know since long back. So I really, from the core of my heart, I thank you very much from all of us that you took out so much time for all of us and delivered nice thoughts and much insight on different aspects for this session. So I thank you so much, sir. I also thank our keynote speaker, Dr. K.K. Satpathy, sir. Sir, you have given a good insight on different aspects of the topic of this session. So I'm very much thankful. And from all of us, I extend a lot of thanks to you, sir. And then I'm also thankful to different speakers and panelists of this session, to name Professor S.N. Yadav, Professor P.K. Bora, Professor M.S. Sevra, Dr. G.T. Patle, Dr. Joy Kumar, Dr. R.K. Majumdar, Dr. Pragati Hajarika. So I am thankful to all of you. And from the whole family of Central Agriculture University, IMFAL, and from all the members of All India Agriculture Student Association, I am thankful. And we think that all the thoughts shared by you will definitely help all of us and all the stakeholders in agriculture, and it will be of much impact. So thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you all. So we can leave the session now and we can reassemble at 2 p.m.
Yeah, next session will start by 2 p.m. Okay, Ashish.
Yes, sir. So we can end this meeting now, sir.
Yeah. Take your own lunch. Arrange.
Sir, VC okay. Sir is also here, sir. Sir,
yeah,
yes.
Yeah.
Also take the lunch. Okay, sir. Thank you very much, sir, for giving the time.
Take lunch, crowd.
Okay, sir.
Okay, thank you to all.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you all, sir.
Thank you, sir.